Hello, la, la, la.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Hello, everybody. How was your weekend?
Weekends are fun.
I'm Michael Scott Shatner.
And I'm Milburn Drysdale. Hi, y'all.
Southern?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whatever, Rob.
Completely lame groaners.
Goody gumdrops.
Let's get to them.
Let's do.
What jolly fat man fills kids' stockings every year with vodka and prescription narcotics?
Which one?
Saint Nick Healthy.
Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God, no.
Hello. This is one of Santa's elves, Michael Scott Shannon.
And I'm also an elf, Milburn Drysdale.
What Hollywood agent always keeps up to date on celebrity deaths?
Mike Obituary?
Mike Obit.
Obit, oh, all right.
Mike Obit.
Sorry, I won't do that to you again.
That's okay, Mil. Say, you seem a bit down in the dumps today.
No, I'm perky. I'm perky as a spring flower.
I've noticed as this cherry feature goes along,
yes,
you seem to lose a certain sense of confidence about this material.
What makes you think that?
Unlike you, I am Scott Shannon, always happy. I could have just come on the air and told you a firework had discharged in a part of my body it should not have discharged,
uh-huh,
and I would still say, hello.
Well, let me say bully to you.
I think I'll win you back.
There you go.
Which Law and Order star always gets arrested for soliciting?
Which one?
Jerry Horback.
Any more? Oh.
Plenty more.
Let's keep rolling.
Plenty more.
This is the good one?
They're all good.
The good one.
What civil rights pioneer can always spot a broken bone? Malcolm X-Ray. Oh. One more, and then you'll decide what mighty brain this material came from. As the groaners get smaller, the laughs get bigger.
Ooh.
Let me just say, for those who serve.
That's right.
Thank I'm Super Shad.
And I'm Milburn Drysdale.
What female pop star is most popular during Hanukkah?
What?
Menorah Jones.
Oh. Hey now.
The Don and Mike Show.
Hey now.
Menorah Jones.
In here.
Wow. Okay, so, well, you've got some thinking to do. Oh, hi there.
Everybody.
All right, again, that was Santa Nick Nolte,
yeah,
Mike Obitz, Jerry Horback, Malcolm X-Ray, and Menorah Jones. We'll start with Michael today.
I'm going to say that was not penned by Rob's B-Wax.
And I'll say it was.
I think I played him in the wrong order, though.
Who was right?
You were, Mike.
Ah, yes.
Those are from...
I'm proud of you, Rob.
Thank you.
Those are from the prep service. But it's a nice compliment from Buzz.
Yes. I do like Mike Obit.
I thought so.
And hello, everybody.
Hello.
Okay, I know. Hi there.
Hello.
Hi there. Hi, Julia.
Hello.
Okay, John Kerry's still in our machine here.
Oh, hi there.
Hi there, Bert. Tony. Okay. Hi, Donna, Mike.
We appreciate it.
Hi, Jerry Lewis, everybody.
Hello.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Okay. Door. Lock.
Yeah.
Rob's intro.
It's a true story. He was a neo-Nazi with one true enemy. Himself. A man of faith. A man of hate. And his soul torn apart. Your discretion advised.
How have you been? Nah.
Tight?
Yes.
I saw you looking at my hair.
Yeah,
it is longer.
Good afternoon, Mr. and Mrs. WJZ13 and all the ships at sea. At this, the most wonderful time of year, they are the princes of peace. Mike Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Thank you, Robbie. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hi there, this is the Don and Mike Show. Let's get retarded. New episode on this Monday.
Monday!
1206.
04.
Hi, Don and Mike. Buzz Burbank here.
No, he's not retarded.
Don and Mike show on Monday, December 6, 20-04. Here's the phone number from anywhere in America.
Yeah.
877-365-3636 from Canada, from Washington. Oh, excuse me, Canada, 800-636-1067 in Washington, D.C., 202-432-1067.
All right.
Those are the numbers. You should know them by now. We already played the tape with the phone numbers.
Yeah, we've given you more information than you need.
That's hi, and welcome to now what is officially the nutty, crazy Christmas season.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
It started. It's starting to attack me now from all points, from all vantage points.
Are you in the spirit?
Not yet.
Me neither.
Not yet. I'm not.
I was kind of in it, and then I lost it over the weekend going out when I had a shopping experience. I kind of lost it because it was just too much.
I'm just not, and part of it has to do with the light situation in my house and the tree situation in my house and all the situations in my house
With other humans, and I don't know whether it's because I'm too I'm getting too long in the tooth to do this. I feel more bombarded with retail merchandise, buy this year than I ever have before.
Now, you know me. I'm a capitalist. That doesn't bother me.
I don't know what it is.
I love sales.
Me.
I love going out and buying
love
stuff from
merchandise.
People. I love merchandise. My problem is always is people.
Yeah.
And even people who are too friendly. I'll tell you about that later. I mentioned that to Mike in the office. I won't bore everybody with it until later.
Oh, mm-hmm. We'll look forward to that.
Bore you with it later. Because I have more pressing stuff I have to tell you about. I can tell you about the fact that my crazy wife rented a van to drive to Ocean City to pick up this demonic painting, which is now hanging on a wall in my house.
It's all up and it's there.
I hope to have a picture of this in the next couple of days at DonnaMikeWebsite.com. But really, I have to tell you about my experience in Baltimore yesterday.
Please. You were on the TV.
Yes, some might say that. Some might say. Here's how the events unfolded. Give me a second on this. Marty Bass, who for years, he's the weatherman, the all-around goofy guy, Channel 13 in Baltimore.
Uh-huh.
So for years, me and Mike would goof on him, and we'd see him, and it'd be no problem. But then the word got back that he was mad about something, and we had him on the show, and everything was cool, and I saw him at this Ravens party, and he was cool, and he said, I'd like to have you come up and do the show with me sometime. And Mike, you are just like me in this regard.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody was to come to Mike today and say, Mike, I've got an event that I need you to help me out on, Mike would say, when is it? And if they said, it's in April, you would say,
sure.
Sure.
Yeah.
Call me. Call me when it gets close to April.
Right.
Because that's just how, on one side, that's really how
short-sighted
soft,
we are.
Soft and tender we are. That we'll say yes.
Sure.
But we only say yes because we don't have the foresight to think ahead.
We're better than we used to be. We used to be a lot worse. I mean, if, we used to be, we'd do it with a two-week, ahead lead time. And then say no when the time got closer.
Yeah, so now we
don't do that anymore.
Now we do it.
But you mentioned the month. That might be, even March, you and I would probably say yes.
So anyway, this was back in August that Marty Bass had asked me this. And I said, I would be glad to, keeping in mind that I was at a function, I was drinking.
Right. Oh, yeah, man, sure.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. So he emailed me, I guess maybe in October, and I wrote him back, okay, well, I'll get back to you, as soon as I can.
Right.
Then he writes me back. We only got a couple of games, so I thought, what the hell? He's a good guy. I'd like to do it anyway. You know me. I don't think I know jack about real sports, but I like football. I watch it all the time.
And any way you slice it, an opportunity to be on that machine that you love so much.
The box.
And it didn't go well. I just want to tell you something. Didn't go well. Here's what happened, and I feel bad for Marty if he got in any trouble. Now, I wasn't like a crazy shock jock saying nasty words.
Okay.
The deal is this. So I set this up with Marty, and I think I had said on the air that Frieda and I were going to go up to Baltimore, have a day of it, go to the game, go on the sidelines, and do the post-game show. This is because I'm stupid, and I don't listen to details. Marty Bass sent me an email 3 months ago that told me that the post-game show was not done from the stadium, and it's not done from WJZ. It's done from a bar somewhere.
I pictured, rafters or the stage risers set up outside the stadium.
As it turns out, Channel 13 had a guy that was in the stadium.
Sure. Right.
He was on the show. Then they had another guy that was in the locker room. He was on the show. And then
weren't out in the parking lot or anything?
No, Marty and I were at a bar in Fells Point.
Fells Point.
Beautiful Fells Point. I love cobblestone steps.
So when the listener called last week and said, see you in Fells Point.
Right.
He meant that he knew where Marty was going to be.
Apparently right. So I didn't know. And I didn't realize this till Sunday morning. Marty calls and says, hey, I've got all of the directions. I've emailed you the directions. Cool. We'll see. I said, I'm looking forward to it.
Nice.
And I am.
Sure.
I get Marty's email, and it says, okay, once you get to the game, you go to this parking lot, blah, blah. You'll want to leave the game approximately at the beginning of the third quarter,
okay.
Maybe even a little earlier to beat the traffic out so that you can make the drive to the bar in Fells Point. With its very tiny, narrow
yes.
cobblestone streets.
And parking not the easiest in Fells Point.
Right. And, man, they got so many homeless people there. I was so afraid that they were going to steal my car. I am so living in a suburban world
right.
that I pulled down there. I was like, oh, my. Look at all these toughs with these do-rags and all of them walking around with they all look like creepy British people. You know the way that creepy British punk people dress?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
With lots of leather and
yeah.
lots of leather. Lots
Some
of,
might say that it's kind of a hip, trendy inner city area.
It's junk. The look is junk, but the area is nice. So I decided, being as my wife was sick yesterday, she didn't really want to go, but she was going to go because she's my wife, and you know it's something that we were going to do together.
Right.
I said to her, listen, and here's the deal. They sent me up the tickets and the pass for the game, which was nice, but the tickets and the pass from the game didn't come from the TV station. They came from the people at Infinity Broadcasting in Baltimore.
Oh.
So these are how the events are going through my mind on Sunday morning. I'm thinking, oh, okay, it's not at the stadium. It's going to be in a bar. That's okay. I'm not even going to see Marty at the game.
No.
I'm going to go to the game and have to hang out with, our idiot general manager of our radio station in Baltimore and all those schmucks. I don't want to do that. Then I got to leave the game early to go drive through. I find it free to listen, babe. You don't feel good. You just stay home. I'll chill out. Work out because for me, I watched the first half on TV.
Mm-hmm.
Watched the first half of all the games. Got in the car, drove to the place. Got there.
So you drove straight to Fells Point.
Drove right to Fells Point.
Right.
Made it there. Was at the bar at the time. Got in. I want to say this about Marty Bass. The guy is a pro. What I love about him, and I am getting him in a little trouble, didn't mean to. What I love about him is the same attitude as when me and Mike do a show, any of us here. Before the show, he said to me, I'm probably going to want to ask you about this or this or this. What do you? And I said, oh, God, I don't even know if I have an opinion on this. I'm not a sports guy. And then he said, well, you know, screw it. Just leave it for on the air. And I like that. That's how I like to work.
Yeah, it's not working without a net.
Let's not have a game plan. Let's just go out and do it.
Right.
So, this screwed me up. This IBF thing. This thing that they put in your ear. IFB.
Yeah.
It's a thing where you hear every freaking person at the TV station
right.
talking in your ear while you're on the air.
Uh-huh.
Now, this is why these TV people look so out of it and so zombied.
Oh, especially when they're doing anything off the cuff because they're being screamed at.
Right. So, Marty is cool. His crew is cool. We got a bunch of our listeners that are down at this place. Max is in Fells Point, and we're ready to go on the air. And they said we got a whole hour to fill. I said, hey, no problem.
So you know you're going to have an hour of television time all to yourself.
Yeah, well, and Marty's got features and stuff. And
cutaways.
You know, it's surreal.
Are you wearing a tie?
No, I decided not to, and it's a good thing. I just wore just a shirt and a jacket. I mean, okay. Not even a jacket, just like a...
Did you go with the mock tee?
You know, I don't know what type of shirt I have. Something like I have on today.
Truthfell didn't it? Wasn't it, was it JB or Rich Eisen?
Rich Eisen
said, don't go with the mock tee.
No. Yeah.
I may have. I'm not sure. I mean, like it matters. I'm an ugly man anyway. No matter how much weight I've lost.
Well, Fells Point,
you know,
so yeah, being casual is okay.
So there's, they keep saying, okay, we're on in five, and it's very exciting because they've got, you know, they're on delay because it's Infinity. Even
right.
a TV thing's on delay.
Right.
And the monitor is right there in front of you.
Uh-huh.
This is where I know I'm the biggest dope in the world. I could not stop looking at myself.
You've always liked to watch yourself on television while you're on television.
On TV. So it starts, and Marty Bass says, you know,
Welcome to the Ravens post-game show. Tough loss for the Ravens today. I'm glad to welcome here my good friend Don Geronimo, Don and Mike showing live 105. He gave me a nice plug.
Yeah, right.
And
nice.
I said, thanks, I appreciate it, Marty, you're wonderful. Frankly, I don't know who's watching this show right now. I can't imagine.
That is your opening?
Yeah, I said, I can't imagine anybody watching this show. The team lost.
Uh-huh.
This is a show that's on an hour later.
Right.
I turned around, we're in the sports bar. I said, there's other games on the other channels right now.
Oh,
I said, and, you know, trying to be a little self-deprecating,
right?
I always say defecating, and they're both true.
Similar.
Anyway, I said, and I'm on this show, so I can't imagine anybody's watching. Let me just say, it's good to be here.
Now, are you getting a laugh from the crowd while you're doing this?
Yeah, and all the guys on the crew are laughing. They get it.
Right.
So we get done with this first segment, and it's awkward because I'm doing everything, like talking when he's talking, and I'm noticing all the things. Like, at one point, I totally stopped the show, when I said... Uh-huh. They had some guy at the stadium, one of these Ken dolls at the stadium, and Marty asks him a question, and while he's answering the question, Marty's like talking to the 8,000 other people, and his ear said he's talking to people, he's having a drink, and they come back, and I say, this is the problem with television. This is why these people are all zombies. Nobody listens to anybody. I said, while that guy was at the stadium talking, Marty wasn't listening to the answer to the question. And Marty was cool with this. He was laughing with this.
Good.
He dug it.
Yeah. Here's good.
Here's the problem. I had to apologize to Marty. I see. We go to commercial. We went on the air at 5 o'clock, live TV on Channel 13. 5:10, we go to commercial break. He says, man, that's great. I mean, he's loving it. He said, we're having a good time. Things are cool. He walks away, and I see him on his cell phone. I don't think anything of it.
Right.
We're coming back, and I hear on the IFB, or IBF, whatever
IFB.
It is, this thing in my ear, where you hear every person that works at the TV station can talk to you. I hear 4 or 5 people say, hey, Marty, how'd you like that phone call from Jay? Hey, Marty. How about Jay? Hey, Marty. Jay was on the phone.
I think
the guy's name is Jay. So anyway.
Right. Where's Jay?
He comes over, and I said, hey, I'm hearing this chatter. Who's this guy? And he said, he's the general manager.
Uh-huh.
And I said, what's up his butt? And he said, well, here was his quote. How could you start a show by saying, I can't imagine anyone is watching this show? Not knowing that, come on, listen, dude, you know, I'm not there to offer serious football analysis.
Right.
I mean, it's a bar.
You're there to be the jester.
It's a bar. I'm there with Marty Bass, who isn't a football expert either. You know, you're liking the game. So nobody said anything to me, like, don't mention this again. So when we got back on the air, Marty said so, Don, that play today with Ed Reed and McAllister, that was the plays on the screen. I said, that's really incredible. Can I take a moment to say hi to Jay or Jack, whoever the general manager is out there that's calling in and doesn't like what I'm doing?
Was that when the eyes got a little wide?
Well, Now listen, everybody was very cool.
Oh, my God.
Nobody says anything to me. They're all laughing and stuff.
Good.
But I noticed during the next commercial break, Marty walks away again.
Cell phone went on again, huh?
Cell phone goes on again. And he comes over to me. It could not have been cooler. He said, listen, I think it's great. He said, it's the second time now the guy's called me.
Right.
You're going to have to stop referring to him by name. Now, I don't even know the guy's name.
Well, thank God you didn't give him a nickname.
I don't even know the guy's name.
Yeah, I mean, he should understand the radio GMs. I mean, the first thing we do is find the soft underbelly.
Right. And then at some point, there's some director back at the station who says, or some roadie, some flunky, I'm not sure, because they're saying things in your ear while you're talking on TV. They're saying, like, we're going to go to the emails in the next segment. Don, are you ready for the emails in the next segment? The next segment will have emails. Don, emails. You know, all of this is going. And then I hear someone else say, Don, can you hear me? And I'm nodding my head. You know, they go, Serious football only. Serious football only.
Oh, really?
Like, I'm looking at it and go, wait, hold on. And then Marty asked me some question about, like, Brian Billick. And rather than just talk about what a Peabody I think he is, you know,
uh-huh,
I go into this whole crap about, he's one of the most underrated
coach is done. And I'm thinking, why am I doing this? Why I want to say what I want to say on this show.
Yes.
And
it's formal television.
In that area, in that regard, I did not. Although they had, listen, this GM's worried about me making a joke. They got no problem showing people, very nice people, incidentally,
right. Mm-hmm.
Just bombed out of their minds, you know, these hard...
Well, the people that are at Fells Point an hour after the game...
Oh, I know.
...are there for one reason and one reason only.
Right. Yeah, I know. They just,
they're the people that embrace Sunday as just an extra day to drink.
They want to get hammered. So it was fun. And I loved the fact that while plays were on TV... I could say, oh, look, here's this. And I, you know what I did? I did the dumb John Madden thing.
Right.
Where I couldn't help myself. I said, oh, he's coming around the corner now. Look at boom. Boy, he goes there. Boom. He goes. And I said, this is fun. Oh, man. Do I like this?
So this is when they were showing replays in the game?
Yeah. And then the only other thing
was
that
a lot of replays? Was the game, was it really a lot of analysis of the... You said they went to get hammered, the people at the bar.
Oh, I turn it off. Please turn it off, please.
Click.
So the last thing that I even remember.
Can I see the tape?
No.
Oh, what? Oh,
I wanted to take
click.
I always like to take advantage of when you're really, really annoyed at the at the thing.
Oh, no, I'll never let it go. I'll be mad at it, but I couldn't let it go.
Okay.
I couldn't take a hammer to it.
And there's that. Whenever you determine it, it will happen
click,
someday.
Click, click, click.
Make sure I get it with my heel.
It may not happen.
I don't know.
It may not happen.
Now that if it's a quest now, and I'm saying it will, then,
may not go
then
away.
It never will.
So then the other thing that I found interesting, that I found fun, was that they had promos for like CSI and all this crap that they had to read about whatever was on last night on CBS.
Right.
So they're doing the thing tonight, following us, 60 Minutes, Cold Case, and then the CBS holiday movie with Joe Montana, uh-huh. And they're reading this, and my mic is on. I just said, that's a great show. And nobody says anything, so then I think I got to do something like to save it. And I said, just so jive, I'm lying. I said, I'm going to TiVo that tonight. And I said, no, I'm not going to TiVo that tonight. Why am I going to TiVo that? Why are they running that? And then everybody started looking at me again like, hey, yeah. Knock it off. And the only thing
is, slow down.
The only other thing that I loved about being on this live one-hour show, uh-huh. and the fact that I wasn't there as a football expert, because I'm not. I'm right. A fan.
Mm-hmm.
And I love Baltimore. I do love Baltimore football. That's a great team. And everybody there has been very nice to me. And the Modells came down to be on TV and everything.
Right.
So it was real nice. I loved this thing where there was the split screen. When they would have the good-looking guy at the stadium. And then on the other side, it's me and Marty. Two schlubs in a bar.
Right.
And they got the pretty boy out at the stadium. So one of these times when they're pretending to listen to each other while they're answering questions.
Pretending to listen to each other.
The camera is on both of us. I look at the monitor and I see, okay, Marty and I are in the box on the right. The good-looking guy's in the box on the left. So I just start doing this. Like, remember what Chevy Chase used to do on
yes.
Saturday Night Live?
Yes.
I go like this with my hand. I go, and it was silent, but I was going,
the puppet motion.
Yeah. And it's funny because the guy at the stadium looks at the monitor and sees it. And these guys, you know, they don't know how to react to
right.
it. No, I'm like
being
so they just
badly behaved.
They just go on sure. with the show. And I got done, and I thought, you know, I don't know if that's a train wreck or if
right.
it was something. It's live, local TV.
Sure.
I think I was sweating like Marion Barry.
It happens.
Positive,
it was like Albert Brooks in Broadcast News.
I'm positive I'm looking at myself all the time in the monitor, all the time, like a rook, just like a mook. I'm there. That's me. And as a matter of fact, I may have stopped the show on more than one occasion when I just
said. You know, another thing you do is, like, whenever we've been interviewed, you know when you're supposed to be looking at the interviewer and you'd look at the camera, you know.
So if I can't help it.
Camera or the monitor, you'll you'll always look at it.
Well, I don't know.
And it yeah. always becomes that little thing where it's just like, well, I'll tell you, Marty, and then right into the camera.
So the thing ended and it's live and it's got all this junk, all these commercials and all right. this. You gotta. go to this tape, and, you know, I make a comment about the guy, he's interviewing some guy, some coach on the Ravens. I said, this guy looks like the Crypt Keeper. This guy, do these people sleep? Really, this guy, Matt Cavanaugh, the offensive coordinator, I think, for the Ravens. Marty is interviewing him in videos, and the guy has got, like, the bags under his eyes, like you wouldn't believe.
These people sleep. You're just concerned for him.
I am.
Right.
Did
Marty give you some feedback?
Yes. Marty said to me after the show, and really, he had no reason to BS me, because either it had gone horribly wrong or horribly good. He said to me, that's the best show we've done all year.
There you go.
That's it.
And I said, well, you know, if you think so, you're the TV guy.
Right.
You know, and then I just left as fast as I fast as I possibly.
So no dinner in Little Italy.
No. When I set that up with him, my wife wasn't with me.
Yeah, right.
I said, I can't go socializing without my wife. I'm awful. I'm bad with people. I barely made it through this thing tonight.
Your wife wasn't with you. You didn't go to Little Italy. If she wasn't with you, you could have gone to the block.
Yeah, right, Pollock Johnny. I did manage to mention Pollock Johnny, Domino's.
Good.
Bromo Seltzer,
wonderful.
William Donald Schaefer, and I forgot the dead lady with the jumping frogs. I forgot
Virginia
her name.
Virginia Baker.
Virginia Baker.
It's a frog.
So anyway, that was last night. That's fun.
Yeah.
That's fun.
It's good, and I like that you stirred things up, and you know, it wouldn't be you if you didn't have the GM calling, you know?
Yeah, how funny.
Serious football only.
How funny is that?
Hotlined on TV.
Jesus. But really, I mean, even in the bar, with no offense to anyone who works at Channel 13, they seem to be very nice people. I had a good time with the crew. They were all pros. They were great. Getting that dumb thing, that dumb wire put up your back of your shirt so you got the earplug. They all were watching, like, the Eagles-Packers game on TV. And they were working on the TV show.
Sure.
So, anyway.
Yeah, the big you know, afternoon game.
Here we go. Can I have a moment?
Yeah.
With somebody? You know, I'm amazed that anybody's calling that actually saw this yesterday.
Well, you might not be aware of the fact that we are on a very powerful FM station in Baltimore.
I know we are.
And you're probably going to have a large segment of the individuals that watched you on Channel 13.
But why you? But why wouldn't they have just watched the football? I would have.
Because you're a novelty act, right?
Hello.
It's different than the average fair.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don.
Yeah.
It was nice having you up here. It was the best show by far that they've ever done.
Well, then all their shows that they've done previous must really stink. That's the other thing that they got mad at me for.
Right.
Listen how innocuous this is. At one point, they're talking about the coach of the Bengals, Marvin Lewis, this guy that used to be a coach with the Ravens.
Right.
And they said, now, we don't want to say that he's bad,
mm-hmm.
and we don't want to say that he, you know, because they were afraid to say sucks.
Yeah.
So I just said, he stinks. And the room just stopped.
Ooh.
And the camera goes on me, and I said, Marvin Lewis stinks. I mean, and I don't give a rat's ass about Marvin Lewis.
Right.
He's just saying whatever I could.
Something, you know, about on the radio, when we say something, it just kind of goes out and floats around for a little while, and it's gone. Something about TV where it just lingers
there.
It hangs around a little longer.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello.
Hey, Don, I saw you guys last night. I have to say, we only watch the show after the game, usually because we like to sit around and make fun of Marty Bass and all the toothless drunks behind him in the bar. But it was phenomenal. In fact, the best part about it was when you actually, I guess you guys cut to, was it like Mark Viviano or somebody at the stadium? The stadium was empty. He's standing there with his finger up his nose, and the producer comes from behind the camera, and you make fun of his shirt.
Well, what they did was they brought out this guy because it's like it's TV on the fly.
Right.
Marty Bass says to this Ken doll at the stadium, he says, you know who thought was going to win today? Bring out the producer. So they bring out this guy. And he's a behind-the-scenes guy.
Right.
And they totally put this poor bastard on the spot. He's on TV, and he says, I thought the Steelers were, or the Bengals were going to win the game. I just had a feeling. And, like, it was going.
Everybody hates him now.
It was going nowhere, so I just piled on. I said, at least I dressed up to get on TV today.
That's good.
With that guy. I mean, I was
lying.
Trying to help him.
Yeah. So far, the reviews are in, and they're good.
Well, hold on. I see a couple of bad ones here. Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don. How you doing?
Hey.
You know, I've never watched that post-game before, and most likely I won't ever again, but from what I saw, it was good time. It was a fun time. And you know, probably regular viewers would not have appreciated your brand of humor, but that was complete D-O-N-I time, and that was classic you all the way.
Get out of here.
Like the show.
Get out of here. Here's a hate call. All right, John.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
Hey, Johnny.
I'm calling from Lake Tahoe. Wanted to give you a shout out, number one, from over here. We listen to you all the time.
If you're in Lake Tahoe, how could you have seen the show in Baltimore?
I didn't see the show, but I want to comment because this is your show last Friday.
Oh, shut up!
You can't comment if you haven't seen it.
No. For goodness sakes, Dave. Hello, Dave.
Hey, Don.
Yeah.
How you doing?
Doing great, thanks.
I want to tell you, you're too self-effacing. First of all, you're very, very handsome.
Okay? Oh, listen, I'm not talking to any faggots on this show.
No, not faggots. Second of all, you're not just a fan, you know. You're an expert.
No, I'm not. Listen, please, I'm not an expert
on
football.
Well, you've done a post-game show for the Redskins. Your body of football knowledge is significant.
Any schmuck can get a job doing a radio show for a sports team, especially if you do the pre...
I disagree with that.
Mike, let me just cite some of the great names in pre- and post-game history, at least locally.
Okay, all right.
Well, Charles Mann.
Former player, though, so he falls in that category.
Hello, Tom.
Don and Mike, how's it going, buddy?
Okay,
Don. How are you?
Don, did an outstanding job yesterday, buddy.
Oh, come
Best
on.
Best show ever of that. But listen, one quick question. Before Marty went to the second commercial break, who was the fat tar that he had in a purple sweater?
Okay, now what I tell you guys in the office,
right?
Yeah. There was, and I don't think he had a purple sweater. Here's the deal. Thank you, my friend. It was the only moment that I felt awkward during the show.
Sure.
I'm lying about that. I felt awkward during the whole thing. There was a guy in the front row, a guy who really, I mean, no joking.
No, he's not retarded.
I mean, it was, you know, at least I made
challenged
50-50.
Okay.
So he had the big. Giant face. I mean, I'm not kidding about it. Right. Like as big as a pizza tray. I mean, a big
pumpkin face.
Yeah, and like the goofy teeth. You know,
right.
Goofy toofies.
Sure,
he's got those. No, I can't do that, Rob. I can't do that now. See, even I have a conscience.
Right,
even I do. No, I can't do that. She comes out like a rose.
So he's a big fan.
So the guy, he's a fan of the Ravens. I don't think he knew me from Adam.
Okay.
Right. So at one point, Marty Bass, because this is a live show, he goes over to the corner and he's going to give the retarded guy a line to say. And the line is, it's right on the screen in front of him, WJZ.com, whatever the TV's web station is, if you want to email it.
Mm-hmm.
So Marty goes over and says, hey, you want to read it? And the guy goes, you know,
WJZ.com.
Now, at this point, I got off whatever the chair is that I'm leaning up against, and was just going to walk over and get my beverage. And I see Marty. It's the only time that I saw him panic. He gives me a little shake-off sign like, no, 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 no. Don't come over here now. And I wasn't going to go over there now, but I know his fear was...
That you were going to go over and like, stand next to the guy or
that
something?
That I'd go over and go, hey!
Right, you know, point at him and laugh or something
hey,
like that?
Hey, dude, what's happening?
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted
a beverage.
I was cool with it.
You were well-behaved.
I tried to be. I swear to God, I tried to be.
Listen to the reviews. It sounds like the reviews are in.
Well, I don't know. I thought it sucked. Hello, Shabir.
I was a little disappointed because I watched it because you said your wife was going to be on.
Uh-huh.
But besides that, I almost had to wear shades because your forehead was shining like a spotlight.
You had mentioned before that it was warm in there.
It was warmer. They had a spotlight, but I mean, you had a reflection going off the dome like nothing.
Okay, thanks. I got a question for you.
Yeah?
Why'd you attack our country?
Okay, get out of here.
Hello, Ben.
Hey, what's up?
He's probably right.
First time caller.
You probably had to put on sunglasses at home to watch me. I probably was shiny as hell.
Did they give you a little pancake before you went on? No makeup?
Nah. 13, just come on in.
Yeah.
Thank God I didn't take them up on their many gracious overtures to enjoy the people and some beverages. This is the last thing I need to do is like have a couple of cocktails and come back on the show.
It worked on the old Tonight Show.
Hello. Hello there, Don and Mike.
Maybe
hey, what's
time.
Up, guys?
Hey.
please don't let any of these callers be, you know, the representatives for what you think Baltimore is. My God, what's calling in here today? But anyway.
I think everybody's cool.
Well, no, the emails. Tell them you got a kick out of those emails because they email everything under the sun, and you ripped into this one guy who had these icons, and you said, how do you shave your face in the morning? And I don't know what that means.
How do you look yourself in the mirror in the morning? Right. This is a great technical innovation they have. They say if you have a question about the game, send us an email. So what they put up on the screen is the actual email, right?
So some guys sent him like the smiley faces and
on
stuff.
The bottom of the page, it had like 8 different Santa creepy smiley faces, and one of them was like bouncing up and down. And I said, put that back up on the screen, you know, and I loved... oh, God, for a guy that butchers the language like I do.
Right.
One thing I am good is written stuff.
Uh-huh.
I love looking at the emails and saying, there should have been a comma here. There should have been quotation marks here. There should have been a period here.
Bass loves going to emails like that. He does it on his morning show a lot.
Emails are fun on TV.
His laptop. Let me see what I can bring up on my laptop.
Come on.
Hello. We got a break. Donna Mike. Hi, Richard.
Did you tell him about the guy with the girl? Putting his hands down the girl's pants.
Oh, okay.
What?
This was a good.
You were going to leave this out?
I forgot this. Thank you for the reminder. Right at the very beginning of the show, they're doing one of those shots of the crowd,
right.
And a guy was sitting at the bar with his girl, and they both had their backs to the camera, and the guy had his hand. Not all the way down.
Yeah, but just tucked in. But just kind of like warming his fingers.
Yeah, and the camera was on that for a second and pulled away. And like they were like, everybody, of course, no mention of that.
No,
right. We came back and
spotlighted
it. I said, I want you to know that I have my hand in that exact position right now in Marty's pants.
That's good. That's funny.
Very good.
So anyway, I don't know. Hello, Don and Mike. Brian.
Yeah. Don, you reminded me of Cruiser and Stripes.
Cruiser and
Don't remember
Stripes.
Cruiser and Stripes.
Too long ago.
Thank you, though, my friend. Hold on. Oh, Jason.
Don and Mike, Radio God.
Jason.
There was many times yesterday when you had Marty just dumbfounded, but there was one particular time when you were talking about the Ravens not making the playoffs, and you said, "What?" kept on saying, "What's their record? What's their record?" He said, "Well, they run the table." That he said, and you just looked at him and just said, "Don't say run the table."
Oh, I got into that. I hate the run the table.
Run the table is an overused football.
I hate the run the table.
Yeah. He just got this look on his face like he didn't know what to do next.
Say run the table.
He was great. I do want to say that really, Marty Bass was ultra cool with me yesterday.
I mean,
I could have pulled down my pants, and he would have probably said, "Great show."
Well, I think he likes the show, and that's a good thing.
So anyway, Marty is more than cool. We'll end this with a hate call. Troy.
Yeah. When you first got on the show, your voice was so horrible. What the hell were you doing, smoking cigars?
Yeah. Thank you, Troy. Anyway, what else?
Well, another thing is, bueno gusto.
Hold on. That's the best?
Hey, that's it. That's all they got.
That's it? This looks like a hate call. Rick.
Oh, it's Nick. Hey, hon, how you doing?
Nick.
Hey, I thought you did a good job. It started off great, but I don't know. To me, it kind of looked, the more the show went on, the more uncomfortable you were getting.
Of course. They're telling me not to say what I'm saying.
It got to a point where I remember you were like looking at the camera, and Marty was going on and on and on. And you just kind of shrugged your shoulders like, what do I do?
Well, I believe that's part of my charm, sir.
Yes.
That I did do that a lot. I did look at the camera a lot and shake
On and on.
Like, God, when are they going to stop?
As the show went on.
Going on and on. Have a nice time?
Mary.
Yes.
Mary, you're on the air.
I just wanted to tell you how attractive you were.
There it is.
All right.
Shut up.
Nice. Thank you.
Now, why do you tell her that's a nice compliment?
Because that's not true. That simply is not true. I'm not I think
we liked you.
I believe I was the handsomest man on that program last night, but I don't think that's saying a lot.
Even the sideline reporter that was in the stadium?
I think Mark Valavano. Where were they? I'm Mark Valavano. How you? I got a leather jacket on, too. I'm cute. I'm at the stadium. You're at some stinking bar. Anyway, enjoy the time, and thank you to Marty Bass.
I'd love to get Marty's take on it if we ever get a chance to do that.
Marty, coincidentally, starts his vacation today.
His permanent vacation.
I did throw out the invitation, and he said he'd love to come on sometime.
I'd like him to be on a desert island somewhere.
return the favor. So thank you, Marty Bass. That was fantastic.
Good.
I didn't even have time to tell you about the stupid painting in my house. You know what? How about this? I'll put myself on the back burner for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we come back, spotlight on my best buddy, Mike.
Amen.
Okay, we'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Kind of exciting right now. We've got the 26th annual Frog Hop. Virginia Baker is organizer of all this. Ms. Baker, why did you decide to go ahead and do this? What's the point of this?
Let's see. Mayor McKeldin, he was our mayor. Don't you have a booklet with our history?
We've got all that. But why did you decide to do a Frog Hop?
Well, he sent me an application when he was mayor, and I thought, we're in a world, and I said, we're in something. I'm going to get a frog. So nobody had a frog. I'm a city girl. The mayor at that time was a city fella.
Okay.
So I started you all with publicity.
Okay. We have to run right now, but thank you, and it looks like a really good idea. In fact, we've got some frogs on the loose. It's going to be going on for a couple more minutes, and look out, because here come the frogs.
They gave her the bum's rush, didn't they?
Yeah. Professional interviewer, professional interviewee.
Always immensely thoughts. The Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, yeah. Oh. Here it is Monday, and on Friday, Rich Eisen will be on from the NFL Network, which is brought to us by Tower Records at Tower.com. No one has a bigger selection of the music and movies you love than Tower and Tower.com. We'll give away $1,000 today.
Whoa.
We've got all this Christmas cash. We're not going to do one of those, like, home for the holidays, the jive, dumb,
right,
stupid radio things, but we have about $8,000 to give away.
Good.
Wow. That's left over from this year. We'll do that today. Also, William Shatner today with his brand new record.
The Girl with Kaleidoscope Eyes.
Mike?
Yes.
Before we get to the Mike O'Mara mailbag.
Yes.
I
got a great letter today.
How was the parade with your girls on Saturday?
It was great. It was great. It was long. It was the parade was...
Was it great or long?
Well, I was lucky because I was... you'll be amazed to know this. I was in the dignitaries section.
Wow. Me.
A dignitary.
Now, this was at the
Manassas Christmas Parade.
Christmas Parade.
Which is huge. I mean, huge. I had no earthly idea it would go on this long. And I was in slot number 8, so I actually was early in the parade.
Yeah.
I was right behind the mayor.
Now, are you in a car?
Very, very excited. Not right behind the mayor, but like one, they had like the Grand Marshal, who I think was president of the Chamber of Commerce, and then they had...
Hey, that's right.
Then they had the mayor, they had some state senators,
had
some
the school,
delegates.
School marm.
My title?
Yeah.
I was the honorary Grand Marshal.
Hey.
And I was thinking about it. I was thinking about a lot of things. I was thinking about the status of being the honorary Grand Marshal, and I was saying, this is probably as good as I would ever get. I think this is big time
now,
for me. I would never get, you know, with my status in the world, I don't think I would ever get Grand Marshal. But so honorary Grand Marshal. I didn't even know that was I knew I was going to be in this parade with my daughters. I didn't know I would have the title.
Wow.
And I was excited.
Sure.
And I saw because they wanted me to do it last year.
Please.
I think the sign was from last year.
Please answer my question.
Yes.
Are you in a car, in a convertible,
or
are you in a
Camaro? And I think I broke it.
How do you think you broke it?
I think I broke it because, which of course would lead to the letter that I know you have. I think I broke it because he the guy, Mr. Sloper, I forgot what his first name is. I just remembered his last name.
Oh.
Who was driving the car? Put a. It's a Camaro. No, stop it.
Jesus.
They put the Camaro thing down. I'm talking. They put the Camaro thing down and then cover it.
Okay, that's all.
With a plastic, like, thing that covers the well where the ragtop goes in.
Right.
And when I sat on it, my first daughter got on it and it was fine. Then then I get in between them and my daughters are on either side of me and I hear this. And it kind of, I don't know if there was any permanent damage or not, but
bad sound effect.
It stabilized after that, and then we had to wait. And for me, I got there, I was told to get there at 9 o'clock, mm-hmm. and the parade didn't start till 10:30. So being a parade novice, and you know how punctual we both are,
correct.
I was there a little before 9 o'clock, and then, you know, you have the whole waiting game.
Hurry up
and
to wait.
And had to wait for the car. Mm-hmm. And they're bringing in the different cars, and I'm, you know, I'm chatting with the mayor, and you know, I'm feeling very, very excited about the parade. You know, I love watching parades, so the fact to be in them is even more exciting for me. I would be more excited probably than my daughters are. They're 9 and 7, and they, you know, they're cold, and I got them hot chocolate, and they were sitting there, and it was just a long wait. I can't imagine. For the people that were, they told me something like 127 slots in this parade where people had to wait, like with bands and floats and drill teams and horses and everything. And the parade went from 10:30 in the morning, and I think it ended at 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Wow.
Oh, boy.
It was a long parade.
That sounds like a jail sentence
to
me.
It was a long parade. But I got done early. I mean, it was just, it was over almost as soon as it began. Right. And I got out, and I went out, and I was eating lunch right after that.
Mike, we had a lot of people call about them. You know, here's
yes.
A guy that was at the parade.
Oh, good.
Lee.
Yes, Mr. Amara, I was one of the great unwashed who happened to see you this weekend, and you did an excellent job.
I did a good job. Well, I really didn't require any skill, the waving, the parade wave. I did try to work both sides of the street, and I didn't do what this one guy did that I saw when I was walking back along the parade route. And it's this bad thing that I hate. It's when you extend your arms, when you're sitting on the back of a convertible, and you extend your arms, and it's almost like a little bird move with your hands waving at both sides.
Right.
And it's like, it's people that can't justify looking away from one side of the street.
Will you do that again?
It's like this little, you know, and this one guy's going like this, and he's a big guy. He's sticking his hands out, and he's waving his... Both arms are extended,
both sides,
and then
of
the wrists
street.
Are bouncing up and down like he's fluttering his hands, and he's like, "Hi, Merry Christmas!" And then he's pivoting his head back and forth. That's a bad parade style.
Would you just do that thing with your hands again?
Yeah, here you go. It's like this.
That's,
you know,
great.
Doesn't that look gay?
That was kind of why I wanted you to keep doing it.
What I would do, I would switch hands. And I got my arm around one daughter, then I'd go to arm around another daughter, and I'd wave at both sides with one hand, one side of the street, and I'd talk to people if anybody would have anything to do with me, right. and it's cool. Got a really great, at the reviewing stand, there was kind of a Mac McGarry there that, you know, did the, and now please welcome, and he got it right. They didn't get the call letters right, though. And this sign apparently was from last year. The call letters were Mike O'Mara from WMFK.
WJFK.
So I asked the nice lady who was organizing things if they could get like just a little piece of masking tape and put a J on it. But
that would be Melvin Fitzgerald Kennedy.
But it was very nice to you know, to see everybody, and you know, not a lot of heckling, which you know, I think, you know, my daughters in that circumstance are kind of like my bodyguards. You know, you're not gonna get heckled when you got two cute little girls with you, and they had a good time. I was more into it. I think maybe I was more impressed with it than they were. And I'm like, hey, so do you like that?
That's right.
Yeah, you like being in the parade? Isn't that great? Yeah, all right, Beth. Yeah, it's all right. You know, so, it's okay. And so they, because with them, you know, with little kids, that's a, you know, to smile and wave for that entire parade route.
Yeah.
It was great. I was very happy, and I had a lot of nice things said to me.
I'm sure that you mentioned them on more than one occasion. Now listen, Daddy is a business owner of this community. For the next 2 hours, okay, we're going to smile,
like,
we are going to wave. And when we get past the giant helium-filled whiskey bottle, you are both going to stand and salute. Okay? Do you get me, girls? Yes, Daddy.
I know. You are to wave and smile, and you're going to enjoy the parade. I hope they enjoy it. Their whole thing, they like to throw candy out. And they weren't able to do that, so that was the one thing. But it, was a good time was had by all. And there were something like, I think there was something like 50,000 people that showed up for this parade. This is a huge deal. It's been going on for 59 years. So it was, I was thrilled. Last year it got, do you know, last year?
If 50,000 people showed up for that, that would be 4,940 people more than showed up at that bar in Fells Point.
Yeah, but think of how many people you saw you on the Magic Box.
I still think your number's higher.
It was fun. And last year it got iced out. There was an ice storm or a snow ice storm, so we got to do it this year. But I won't, as I said to somebody, next year I'm going to have to put my own float together to be in it, because they won't, you don't double up on honorary Grand Marshal. They don't bring you back. That's not a repeat gig, although if it's open, I'd take it again.
You know, I think we should just
I like being in a parade.
I think it's good that you do this with your kids.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we should get past the charade of my daughter's like throwing candy to the crowd. I think now, after 2 years of
that, I like the parade.
I think that yes.
Oh yeah.
That
yeah.
You like being in the parade.
Well, they seem to like it more. They seem to like it less than I did this year. And if that's the case, then they like being on a float. That they would have preferred to be like on one of the floats,
sure.
Throwing candy out, or just hanging out.
All you got to do is build an O'Mara's float.
That's what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
What will it be?
Oh, you. How about the Deathmobile?
Like the how about the
Animal House?
How about, yeah. Yeah, that's exactly
what did it say on the front of that, though? Didn't it say something?
Eat me. Eat me right on front.
A great idea. We'll get working on it.
Big 60-foot cake.
I had a great time. I did. It was. I love parades. But I didn't watch the rest of it, and the parade just went on for like 2 days more.
You know, you mentioned that you liked talking to people,
mm-hmm.
and I'm antisocial, but if I'm in a situation like that, when I was at this bar, when you're at this parade, you say hi to people because they came out to see you.
I shouldn't say this. I'm liking it less. I'm moving in your direction. I'm liking it less.
However,
and less.
What, just people in general?
Yeah. I'm liking it less.
Rob applauds that.
I just have to tell you.
I do it a hell of a lot more than you do.
How I really ticked my wife off on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
She was doing something and I had to do stuff. I had to go, like a thousand million errands.
Yeah,
not a problem. Dry cleaner, grocery store, you know, something with the car. Anyway, I was just, Saturday was one of those days, and I know everybody feels this way. I had stuff that I had to do. It seemed everywhere I went, there was a car that had a Christmas tree strapped to the top of it,
yes.
And the family was happily going 15 miles an hour,
sure.
And there was no way for me to pass them, and it happened a couple of times with people that didn't have the stuff on the car, but there's just people driving slow, and they were just driving me nuts, and by the time I got to the grocery store, I was just fit to be tied. So I had on sunglasses and a baseball hat.
Right.
Not because I got any dumb aspirations that I'm going to go there and be spotted like Julia Roberts.
Mm-hmm.
Simply because if you wear sunglasses in the middle of the day, you're giving off a vibe that says, I'm a jerk.
Don't touch me.
Leave me alone.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got my plan. I'm going through the grocery store aisle by aisle. The first time that someone started talking to me was I've been looking at the peanuts. And a guy said to me, hey, do you like those? Now, the Planters peanuts.
Uh-huh.
Planters peanuts.
I thought they were special peanuts.
Dry roasted peanuts.
Because in the office you called them Planters something peanuts. There's a word in the middle.
What I would have said to the guy, I would have said to him, if I lived in a world where I could treat everybody as I wish, without these crazy rules society pounding down on me, I wanted to turn to him and say,
crazy societal mores.
Hold up and go, Planters freaking peanuts. I mean, there's not a lot to it. But I said to the guy, I enjoy them very much.
I enjoy them.
And then I moved along.
Uh-huh.
I am in the next aisle, and I'm looking. Here's a shock. I'm looking at the Atkins products, okay? Uh-huh. And another guy, now not women, guys, a guy pulls up next to me and goes, what do you think of this? And he's got like some Atkins to bake bread or something.
Yeah.
Now, why are you going to ask me this? I'm looking at the Atkins candy bars, for God's sakes. Again, I looked at the guy and I said, I don't know. It's not really my thing. Meanwhile, I'm pushing this cart away and I'm thinking, why is everybody talking to me? I don't talk to people when I go to the store. And I don't think it's Christmas cheer. Not yet. I think it's just people being nice,
right.
And I got to the list where I got to the point where everything on the list was done. I go to the checkout stand.
People are talking to you like that guy in the boarding house in the movie Groundhog Day that talks to Bill Murray at the top of the stairs when he first comes out.
Although, listen,
here to see the groundhog?
Mike, you know, that really helps me out, but it's not true.
Right.
Because the people are not that overbearing.
Right.
They're really not.
Not
so
that annoying.
So I'm in line in the checkout stand, and the guy behind me says, third guy now, one trip to the grocery store. Having a party this weekend? I turn around and I say, not planning. I want, you know, what I want
now
to
that,
say.
Now, that comment is an invasion of privacy.
Now, what I want to say to him
he
is,
wants to be invited.
I'd like to turn around and say, yeah, there's a party in my pants right now. But I don't say this to him.
What do you want to hear?
What I say to the guy is, I say, no, I'm not having a party. He says, I notice you're buying an awful lot of soda pop. Oh. This is why when I go to the store, I buy everything in mass quantity, so I don't.
You don't get it. What you have to do when that happens is you have to analyze his product and find the worst one there. You know,
I refuse to play that game. So the guy chats with me the whole time.
What are you gonna do with those Q-tips, Sparky?
And you've got that black strip that goes between my order and his order,
the divider.
And his stuff is like almost pushing to the edge. He's got so much crammed up. I just want to get out of here.
You know what you can do normally when that happens? When he says something to you, slowly reach over, take another black separation strip, lay it down between the two of you, and then glare at it.
Well, listen, this is me. This is not him. The guy then says to me, one more time he says to me, we're still in the same line, he says, well, I thought you were having a party because I thought you would be rooting for Houston. Now, I wanted to turn around and say, what in the frig gives you the feeling that I have anything to do with Houston? I live in Virginia. I've got on a regular sweatshirt, and then I realized I got on a hat that we got in Super Bowl last year. Says Houston on the back of the hat. So the guy, I said, no, it was a free hat. We went to Houston one time. Of course, he says, how'd you like it? Now, I'm not going to tell him. And we're on in Houston, so I'm certainly not going to repeat what I felt when we were there for the Super Bowl.
Did you tell him you liked it just about as much as you liked standing in that checkout line?
I said I loved it. And I went out to the car, and I called my wife.
Uh-huh.
I loaded the groceries in the car, and I sat in the car, and I called her up, and I said, I just want to tell you something. I hate people. I wish people would stop talking to me, and I understand this is my problem, because in this regard, Frida, for a change, was very rational with me. She said, were these people that listen to the show? I said, absolutely not.
Right.
You know, because I always do try to make a special, no matter what a jerk I am.
Are you sure that you weren't aware that maybe
they
knew you from the show?
Like, they weren't. Everybody was just...
And they just didn't want to bring up the show.
No, everybody was just in a good mood, a good chatty mood.
Happy Halloween!
A bunch of guys. And Frida said to me, you're killing me with this attitude. She said, what did these people do to you? I said, they spoke to me. I would love when I go shopping. I understand it's my problem. It's really my problem, but that's why I go to the store early on Saturday morning. That's why I do everything early, so I don't have to have any contact with people. I realize how awful that sounds to say that.
People. I understand.
So I don't have to have any contact with people.
You're a man of means. You can get somebody to do that for you.
But, Mike, I like going to the store myself.
See, why?
Because I love it.
Why do you like going to the grocery store if you don't like people?
I don't, but I've got my...
You like products.
I've got, and I know what I like.
You like your name brand products.
And I know that they've overstocked, they've restocked overnight.
Right.
In many cases, they've overstocked. I can get what I want. There's not normally a big line. And I'm not a total jerk. The people that
I don't know anybody that doesn't like the grocery store when it's empty. It's great.
The people that work in the Safeway, I chat with them all the time.
You like to talk.
They're very nice people.
Right.
It was these strangers, and it was because all the way there, everybody that was driving was pissing me off.
Think the groundhog will see its shadow?
No, they weren't.
Howdy, neighbor.
So it was just another great reason for my wife to be happy that she was married to me.
Sure.
Because she mentioned that. She said, I'm going to write that on the list of reasons why you're such a great guy. You are mad because when you were at the grocery store, people had the gall to speak to you.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when she puts it like that, I said, well, it's a bit more than that. She said, well, really, what is it?
It's really not, though.
No, and I had to cave. I had to say, no.
That's really all it is.
You're right. That's That's absolutely it.
It's just a friendly greeting. I think somebody saying having a party is a total invasion of privacy. I mean, you don't react to it, but I mean, you don't have to be super friendly nice, you know?
But the guy,
if somebody says, and somebody mentions a product to you, if somebody was to walk up to you and say, do you know this product? Have you had it? Or, like, hey, do you know, if somebody walks up and says, do you like that car?
See, but here's the thing. I swear to God, I would never walk up to anybody in a store.
Right.
And, like, if they're looking at milk.
Have you ever seen a car you liked at the gas station and asked somebody if they liked it?
Nope.
I have.
Never. That's a jerk move.
It is.
I mean, I'm sorry. I didn't mean
company
that.
No, if it's like a brand new car, I will say, how do you like your blah, blah? And they say, I like it a lot. And I've gotten positive and negatives about it. No. And if somebody's asked me the same question, I'm always very honest. If you're in the market for that kind of vehicle,
how you can learn.
It's the best way to get to, like, the lowdown. Now, peanuts is a different story. You know?
Oh, I get it, because the guy said to me, do you like those peanuts?
Yeah. I'll say, how do you like your Geo? And they say I've had some trouble with it recently. I said, thanks for the heads up.
Yeah.
Have a great day.
And you leave a smarter man.
Go see my friend at the grocery store.
There are a lot more people like you than there are me out there.
No, but I'm telling you.
Some guy asked me how my car is. It was great. You can barely tell the work I've had done in the front end since I plowed into that school bus.
Make something up. But,
yeah, well.
Now I understand what you're going through. I understand what you're going through.
Well, let me tell you that my problems pale in comparison to Mike's. And I don't mean that seriously. I mean just these superficial things that we're screaming about today.
Yes.
My best buddy. Yeah, you know, and I want to clarify that.
Mm-hmm.
Best buddy, like I said before, brother. That's how I look at Mike.
Right. Thank you. Right
best
back
buddy,
at you.
Best buddy, brother. So, I come into work today. Mike's got his mail. And Mike opens a letter. And it, incidentally, spelled Mike O'Mara.
Yeah, which is always, a nice way of saying, you don't know who I am.
Mike O'Mara.
Right.
He opens up this letter. And he's sitting on the couch. And we're just shooting the bull. And the more Mike reads it, he says, you know, I don't even know if I should read this. I should just probably give this to you.
I ought to just hand it to you as soon as I read the first line of the letter.
To read on the air.
Huh.
So I say, okay, give it to me. And then he realizes he's got something good. And he says, no, let me read you a little bit more. So what we're going to do. We're going to take a very quick. I'm lying about that. It's not a quick break. It's the same break as they always are.
That's right. How do you like those peanuts?
But we'll take the break.
Uh-huh.
We'll come back. The guy wrote Mike a letter. Now, you've heard what a screwed up human being I am. The guy wrote me this letter. I would have called him up before the show today to tell him to step off.
Wow.
Mike is, in many ways...
I'm going to go... I would handle it differently. I would call the guy and explain to him how he really made me feel.
Well, we're going to call him, hopefully in a moment.
He really made me feel like...
A dead man! And hear the letter and call the guy as we continue. Very, very close to the holidays now we are.
We hope we're putting you in the holiday spirit.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Can't go to China. What about your job?
Oh, write a letter, move to another borough. Move to Staten Island. It's a lot easier to blend into a sea of people in Staten Island than China, believe me.
Yeah, Staten Island. What about my clothes? How do I get the rest of the clothes?
Well, you come back for your clothes.
I'm not going back in there.
So forget about your clothes.
Well, I'm not starting up a whole new wardrobe now!
Look, freedom and no clothes is a lot better than no freedom with clothes.
Well, should we just take a plane somewhere?
And what, hope for a crash?
It happens.
You know what the odds are on a crash? It's 1,000,000 to 1.
It's something. It's hope.
The Don and Mike Show. You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Right.
Uh-oh. Sounds like somebody's got a case of the Mondays.
Working amongst the drones.
Yeah.
The Don and Mike Show.
Here you go. How about an Ole in New York on WOEN. Spokane, Washington, KFAN, KJRB is Superior, Wisconsin, Mike is WGEE,
right,
and San Francisco, Well, you finally got a time slot.
Yeah.
Cherry time slot. 8 to midnight on KY.
Make sure you position your car in the right direction to get the signal.
In San Francisco. Oh, DonandMikeWebsite.com. It's there, the only official site of this show.
Go to the store.
Yeah. Now, we have to be careful how we do this. We have, on purpose, not been like Bill O'Reilly. Mm-hmm. Saying,
well, he's the best huckster of all time.
Saying, go buy the floor mat, go buy the coffee cup, uh-huh. Go buy the autographed copies of the books. Mm-hmm. We have hats, T-shirts, the jackets, DonandMikeWebsite.com. Order now. You get it by Christmas.
Wow.
Okay.
That's very nice.
So that's it. That's all
the What's the cutoff date for that?
Don't know.
We should probably let people know that.
Don't know. It'd be kind of whorish if we mentioned that. I would think.
Well, no, I mean, no, it's actually kind of practical. No, of course, if we mention that, you know, well, I don't know.
Let's figure it out. Yeah. However, the item that I'll tell you to buy, we don't normally mention this. I urge you to buy the Don and Mike soup. It's tasty, uh-huh. And
nutritious.
The chunks are always a great a bit of exploration and fun with your kids.
Yeah, you never really know what you're getting. And, well, it's even better than mystery meat. Try to guess.
Because it really isn't meat-like, some of the chunks.
And the same guarantee, right?
Yeah.
A little bit of Don and Mike in every can.
Absolutely.
That's right. Now, this letter that Mike got today.
It took a lot of letter writing.
Okay, you're recording it also. Here you go. From one of our helpers.
Oh, good. We love help.
Now, I can understand how this would give you the red ass.
Not as much as you might think.
Well, when you get down to the bottom part.
Yeah. Oh, that.
Okay. November 23.
You got to play a funeral dirge in back of this.
Oh, yeah. We'll need the funeral music, Robbie.
Oh, my. This is a grim, serious sort of letter. You bet your ass it is.
Here's a phone number. When we get like halfway through this, Rob, if you wouldn't mind trying to call... Called Joe. That's his name, Joe. There's the phone number.
Get it, I'm halfway home.
Okay, dear Mike. I'm a longtime fan of the Don and Mike show. Yesterday's comments on your potential health problems have me concerned. I want you around for a good while longer. Keep in mind, I think what Mike said was that your doctor said you have high blood pressure and you got to lose some weight.
Yes.
That was it, right?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, that was it. And since that time, I've... you know, try to, no.
All right, let's.
Sorry.
Never mind with that. Yeah. I want you around for a good while longer.
Yeah.
I sincerely believe that one additional year has been added to my life by all the laughter that you and Don and the gang have brought me over the years.
Well, that's very nice.
That is nice.
You are about to be hit with all sorts of dieting and exercise ideas.
Nope.
And no doubt you'll have setbacks from time to time.
Now, yours is the first one.
As a thankful listener, may I offer a very simple set of goals to keep you on track to a healthier you. Walk. Mike? Take a brisk walk outdoors at least every other day in the morning. No cost. The other W? Water. When in doubt, drink another glass of water. This will help to flush your system and hydrate you. And the most, in my opinion, hurtful of the W's, of the double W's?
Yeah.
Double weddings. Mike? One day you'll want to escort your lovely daughters down the aisle at their weddings.
Jeez.
Make this a solid visual goal. They want you there for that special day. When you feel the urge to backslide, think about those days.
I feel like you on the checkout line right now.
Mike, my hopes and prayers are with you. You know, you didn't announce that you have cancer.
No! But it makes me feel like I do now.
You were one of the first people I smiled and thought about when the Boston Red Sox won the World Series.
Too late for that now.
Mike.
I don't care about that.
Focus on that joy.
Oh, jeez.
Let that sincere happiness inspire your drive to succeed.
Joy.
Here's the biggest jerk part. Drop me an email. Let me know how you're doing. Sincerely, Joe.
Thanks, Joe
listens to the show in Elizabethtown, Pennsylvania.
Uh-huh.
Got him, Robbie?
Funny, he was expecting the call.
He was. So anyway, you
all
know...
Right, may I speak with him?
Yeah, I want to just say, this ain't me.
Right.
Mike read the letter. Mike gave it to me before the show, mm-hmm. said, this is good for the show, and Mike wants to speak to the guy.
Is he there?
Here he is. Here is Joe. Joe from Elizabethtown, Pennsylvania. Joe.
Good morning, my brothers.
How dare you?
What the hell is wrong with you?
Oh, man.
What the hell is wrong with you, for God's sake? Don't you think being overweight my whole life, I'd know how to deal with myself? I don't need this. This is like putting me in the casket already.
I tell him about the W's.
The W's. Now, don't talk about my daughters.
About my intention.
You made me feel like crap.
Well,
seriously.
What is the whole business of you being on the treadmill and the old...
No, okay. Yeah, but it's my treadmill. It's mine. It's my treadmill. That's like going, hey, okay. That's like walking. You know what that letter is? Let me tell you what that letter is.
What's it like?
That letter is the equivalent, Sir Joe, my pal Joe.
Friend.
That letter is the equivalent of somebody coming up to me at a cocktail party, putting their hand on my belly, patting it, and saying, you might want to back off those chips. That's what that letter is, Joe. Hurtful Joe. As nice as you might wrap it, it's still saying, hey, fatso, here's what I need you to do.
Joe is someone of...
How are you, Joe?
Oh, we're doing good.
How are you anyway?
How are you anyway?
Joe, may I ask you, do you, Joe, have anything in your life at all that's not going the way that you had hoped it would? Are there any setbacks, personal, professional, physical,
no,
in your life?
No, of course not. I can answer that question. Nothing's going wrong up on Joe Mountain. Mount Joe. Mount Joe at the pulpit. The big pulpit on top of the mountain. Big pulpit on top of the highest mountain in the world. Which is making my blood pressure go up right now, Joe.
You're killing him, Joe.
You are, Joe.
Not my intent.
Not your intent. Bring my daughters into it. WWs. I get ice breast walk every day. Thanks a lot.
Joe, how tall are you?
Joe, answer, please.
Oh, I'm about 5'8".
Okay, 5'8". And what do we weigh, Joe?
Right now, we weigh about 188.
188. Not a bad weight for a man. I mean, a little heavy, right, Joe?
You be a little chubby.
Yeah, it's cocky.
Joe, around Thanksgiving time, we missed a couple of those brisk walks.
Hey, Joe?
Yep.
Recently put a splash of scotch in that glass of water.
Hey, Joe? Let me ask you that, Joe. You know what this could, Rob? I don't want to stereotype people, but Joe, do you drink?
Yes, sir.
Well, you do. All right. See, I thought maybe not. I'm surprised. I'm surprised.
We have a bourbon and soda every now and then.
Every now and then. But you don't drink heavily like I do you, Joe?
Have you ever lost a...
Because, Joe, I just want to say to him, Rob, Joe, a guy that has a drinking problem wouldn't write a letter to another guy like that. I'm not telling you how to live your life, Joe, but would you like to hear my letter?
Mike, you want to send a letter to Joe?
I'm going
to
write one right now.
Oh, this is good. All right. Hold on. I'll give you the same music.
Here's a letter. Joe, recently received your letter. I've got some advice for you, Joe. First of all, I know because I heard you on your radio show mention the fact that you only have a bourbon and water occasionally. Joe, let me tell you something, okay? Here's some initials you might want to remember. D-H. Drink heavily. Start in the morning, knock it off about midnight every night. And sometimes if you start later in the morning, you can go till 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. That's what I recommend. Because really, you'll be so hungover every single day, Joe, that you won't have to worry about taking the time to write sanctimonious BS letters to your favorite disc jockey.
And
secondly, Joe.
Joe, it's only because we want you around for such a long time.
And Joe, here's another initial. Here's some more initials. B.O. Think about those, Joe. Those are butt out. Butt out of somebody else's business.
Body odor, I thought you meant.
Well, that too, I suppose. And then finally, Joe, and this is my final initial for you. P.S. Pound sand. Signed, Mike. Oh, and I'll pray for you.
That's nice. That's a nice touch.
I'll pray for you, Joe.
I like that.
Oh, gosh.
How are you anyway?
We're doing good.
What do you mean we're doing good?
I am doing well.
What's the Queen's third person? Well,
the royal.
Doesn't surprise me from the pulpit of Mount Joe. Any kids, Joe?
No kids.
Oh, really? They may want to walk briskly to prepare for being pallbearers.
No.
No kids yet. Problems.
No, married for 15 years. Wife's unable to have children.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Blame it on her.
Yeah, blame it on.
Blame it on.
I think it's you, Joe.
Blame it on her. Because your guys can't swim.
I think you probably have one swimmer every 8 times.
Blame it on the wife. That's nice. You're on national radio. Blame it on your wife.
I don't believe her. I think she probably could have children.
How are you, Joe?
Joe?
Yeah.
What were you thinking when you wrote your favorite DJ Mike's letter?
My friend with two kids who had a heart attack last December.
You know what? Now you're
and
pulling
I had
that.
Another friend of mine who had a brain tumor the size of a baseball pulled out.
Joe, don't bring that up.
That was the motivation.
If you desperately care so much, I love saying this to people. Join the freaking Peace Corps if you desperately care so much. Otherwise, you know, butt out, dude. But the freak out. If Mike shows up dead one day, you can call up and say, hey, this is Joe. I'm the guy that sent him the letter.
Big fat I told you so.
Yeah.
Joe, anywhere in your rationale for doing this, were you hoping that you and Mike could become friends? Did you think there was a possibility? Outside chance?
Joe?
No, I just enjoyed the show, and I want you guys around for a while. That was the motivation.
Joe! Don't you understand that, mate? You know what that does? That throws me into a depression, Joe.
And Joe...
Joe, I have professionals to tell me that, okay? I am listening to them. I'm paying attention to a certain extent. I am paying attention to what they're telling me. I know what I got to do, Joe. You know, and when I told that story about the cardiologist that looked me in the eye and said, we have grandmothers that last longer on this treadmill than you, that got through to me, Joe. That got through to me a lot more than the letter.
I'm glad.
You know what, that Joe? I know you really do mean well, but you know what that letter is to me, Joe? That letter is the equivalent, really, in a very weird way, of a guy that's kicking a guy when he's down. That's what that letter is.
Not my intention at all.
Taking that, that's how it made me feel, Joe. You deliberately embarrassed me in front of my colleagues.
Or the reporter.
Why can't you treat me like any jockey that you would meet on the street?
I'll tell you. You sanctimonious ass. How dare you? You know, listen, is your life so perfect that you... You know, let me just... Mike already said the thing about the fact you won't have kids, you know, and they won't be able to be your pallbearers.
Right.
But... You know, I mean, dude, it's okay. You want to write Mike and say, take a walk, drink water, like he's not heard that a million times. Mm-hmm. But you got to lay this stuff on him about his daughters, you know, implying he's going to be dead by the time they get married.
And then I bring you up and I say, why? And you bring your dead friends into it. Or are they living?
They're living, but they're having a very tough time.
All right, but Joe,
how about
Joe? I had the professionals tell me that, Joe.
Why'd you look in the mirror, Joe? Are you that perfect, my friend?
No, not at all. I need to lose more weight. Need to exercise.
Well, Joe, you know, listen. After all this, you know, you have stayed on the line. You took the phone call. Perhaps sometime, if you're in the area, we could take a brisk walk together. You know why I suggest that, Joe?
Why, Mike?
Because, Joe, you're all the way up in Pennsylvania, and I'm down here in Virginia, and I know the odds of that happening are absolutely nil. Joe, are you there?
I'm still here.
Joe?
Now, Joe, don't be quiet on this.
Joe, what is your barren wife's name, or first name, may I ask? We've given no last names here, Joe.
It's Lynn.
Lynn. Joe, it's a letter from me, Don, to Lynn. Dear Lynn. Hi, it's Don from the Don and Mike Show. Your retarded husband, Joe, sent us a letter. Joe said some bad things to my best buddy, Mike. I want to say something to you, Lynn. You can have children. Joe has been lying to you. You can have children. It's not too late.
This is a letter to Joe's wife.
Oh, I'm sorry. dear Mrs. Lucky.
May I ask Joe a favor?
Yeah.
Hey, Joe?
Yes?
I'm very serious about this now, okay? We need the funeral music again.
Oh, you got it. There you go, Mike.
Joe?
Yes?
Yeah, and I mean this from my ticker.
Don't whisper, Joe.
Which I've got to pay attention to. Joe, will you do me a favor?
Go ahead.
After I pass away, will you walk my daughters down the aisle, Joe? Man, that is so nice. You're the bigger man, Mike. Can you do that, Joe? Can you do that? Joe, let me ask you this seriously. This is very serious. When you got the phone call, what did you expect it was going to be, thank you?
Lynn?
Oh, no, because I was listening to the show, so I knew.
Okay, all right.
Lynn, if you're listening... I'll tell you that everybody in this room, with the exception of Buzz, is fertile. We've proved it. I think we could get some kind of a cocktail going for you. If you want a child that's the best of both myself and Mike and Rob.
Listen, he wrote the letter to me. I have two beautiful daughters.
Mike, you do it on your own?
I would be more than happy to
fill a cup.
No, I don't have to do that. I'll do the whole thing. I, you know, why make it impersonal?
You would be glad to.
Joe, how about those apples?
You know, I'll say this, Joe. Mike is very, very fertile. Both times with his wife, he didn't even try.
Joe, who's the celebrity your wife most resembles?
My.
You know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You know, you just you provide me with a bottle of Jameson's Irish whiskey, and I would be more willing to try as. And you know what, Joe?
A pillowcase.
I'll go once.
pillowcase.
Joe, I would be willing to try for as long as it takes
to get your wife pregnant. All right, Joe, listen, it's just our way of helping the same way you're trying to help.
Joe, I just want to say thank you, sunshine. I appreciate
the care.
And have Joe, you and your wife have a happy holiday.
You do the same with your families, guys.
Okay. Don't miss any weddings.
Yeah, we will, Joe. Joe, and I'll bet you that we'll be around with our families a lot longer than you will, because that's right, you can't have kids.
Mm-hmm.
But don't worry, Lynn'll get that magic stuff she needs somewhere. She'll get some of that high-octane stuff somewhere.
Take care, guys.
Bye, Joe.
Bye-bye.
Oh, and Joe, even though we don't do a dirty show anymore, when your children that are born with another man's stuff, when they're old enough, they can come on our show and take their shirts off. And we'll say, do you remember your dad, your fake dad, Joe? Oh, Joe?
Yes, sir.
Remember this. In the words of Billy Swan, as you go through life, since you tried to send Mike a letter, I want to say this to you. When you're going to the fertility clinic and you're trying to figure out how come your guys won't swim and your wife needs something, we can help.
If you got a problem, don't care what it is.
Listen, Joe.
You need a hand.
Hold on, Joe. We can help.
We can help each other.
Too strong on the forearms. We can help. Now, listen, here's the important part. It would sure do us good to do you good.
Let me help.
Let us help. Get a hotel room with your wife.
I think Joe's, Joe, you fading on us here?
He said he had to get back to work.
Oh, I think he's hanging up.
Oh, is he
didn't make it.
Is he gone?
He didn't make it.
Oh.
And he's gone. Bye, Joe.
That's too bad.
Thanks so much.
That's too bad.
Appreciate it. Well, I appreciate it.
You feel better now?
I do.
Good.
I do.
Me too.
That made me feel alive.
That was a good segment.
A lot more than that letter did.
Good segment.
Yeah.
Let's go to Hooters.
And get the fried wings.
We got a break. We'll be right back, everybody.
This is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
Me? That's why the bosses sent me out here. They wanted me to make sure none of the other crews robbed the joint. Like these two f***ing balloon heads over here. They were going to try to bang us out of 200 f***ing grand. Yeah, right.
The Don and Mike Show. Broadcasting with a belated sense of urgency.
Yeah.
Don Geronimo and Michael Mara.
Do an instant request right here.
Hello?
Bethann McBride?
Yeah.
You got it!
Come on, come on, come on, come on.
That was tight. She didn't request this song. did Billy call?
No, he hasn't called yet.
Okay, well, then we'll talk to him tomorrow.
Okay.
Okay.
For you, sir, the greatest man in show business.
That's for you, B.A. Bye-bye. We'll talk to William Bush tomorrow.
Very good.
From Accent Hollywood.
Wonderful.
Because I got, as always, a list of stuff from over the week. Oh, you know what? I've not even mentioned. Well, I won't waste your time with it today. And we'd be wasting your time to tell you about this picture and the van. You know, my wife bought that.
I'm not doing a cheap show for the website. Is it going to be up on the website so I can see it?
Yeah, I think in the next day or two, I got to get my wife to take a picture of it and put it up in the daily recaps on the website.
Mm-hmm.
I'll talk about it in detail tomorrow.
Okay.
I will have the picture up tomorrow with this thing. This demonic.
So now that it's in your house, you're not delighted.
No, it's demonic. It's got eight different arms coming up. It's got a breast. It's got like the lotus position. It's got some guy you can see through his leg. It's got like a skeleton thing. It's creepy, and it's on the wall in my house.
So many things I wanted to mention here today. Will Smith, Nick Nolte, stuff that's in your keyboard, in your computer. Not amazing to me that the Nicolas Cage, Nick Cage movie is still number one again this weekend at the box office. I know you saw it, Mike.
I know it's number one in the nation. If I could just say briefly, I know it's number one. I know a lot of people are going to see this movie. Either I missed it or I didn't read the reviews. I don't think, I know it's already, it doesn't need any help, but I will tell you, it's the best movie I've seen in a year.
Wow.
I don't like the genre. I don't like action-adventure movies. This is the best one I've seen in a long, long time.
Welcome to the dumb side, Mike.
It is a thinking man's Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Oh,
it's great.
Like that.
It's great. It's
number one also because there's nothing else out there.
But what's great about it is I go to these movies, and I'm not out normally. This is one I took my kids to it, and I think it's kind of fun because I like all my action adventure movies to just have a shred of something where, hey, maybe in some kind of situation this could happen.
Well, I
don't. I know. Well, wait a minute. I'm saying it's a good movie. You dig it too.
I know I would.
It's very, very cool.
I love it. The discussion I had with my wife was, what are we going to see? And I said, well, the Nick Cage movie. She goes, no. She said, I want to see Finding Neverland. Ugh. With Johnny freaking Depp.
I know, and what you like. I know what some of the stuff Rita likes. I think she would like it, too.
The other choice, which we both turn our noses down on, and America seems to be eating up with a big wooden spoon, is Christmas with the Cranks.
Oh, yeah.
I
don't have to go see that.
I don't care how bad things are at the movies. If your choice is Christmas with the Cranks, and God forbid you get in there and you enjoy it,
mm-hmm.
Really, you should be shot and sent on the next boat to Haiti.
Uh-huh.
I'm not kidding. Having said that,
yes.
Oh, my wife hates it when
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, no, but I live with the woman. I love this. We're gonna try to get this guy on the show.
Uh-huh.
This is from Green Bay. Now you got to. Oh, and also the Packers. My team got killed yesterday by Philadelphia.
Yeah. So many guys got killed yesterday.
They play Detroit next week. J-Dubs has already approached me.
He's got problems.
Before the show today.
What does he want?
I think anything. I might bet a tattoo with him on the Packers-Green Bay, the Packers-Detroit game
this
weekend.
Where you would get tattooed?
Yeah. I'm sure the Packers are not going to lose to Detroit. They stink. I would be willing to get a tattoo of the score of the game put on my arm in a prominent location.
I was processing that it was Philadelphia that was going to play Detroit, but no, it's Green Bay.
It's Green Bay and Detroit next week. No matter how crappy the Packers looked yesterday, they're going to beat Detroit.
Well, Detroit won yesterday, right?
Yeah, Detroit played Arizona yesterday. They stink. Anyway, there is a game. I know this because I've checked the schedule because I'm the super fan. I am a fanatic about football.
I know you.
I love it. Everything. I know that there's a game on Christmas Eve day. I know that it's a Packers game. I know that it's at 3:00. To me, that's a gift from God.
Right.
That on Christmas Eve, you're going to have the Packers play. Now, here's the choice for the people of Green Bay.
Where are the Packers playing?
Minnesota.
All right. Oh.
Here's a choice for the people. Robbie, would you pick up the hotline? If that's Billy, tell him see you tomorrow. Here's the deal. The game's at 3:00. Christmas Eve is also the day that we set up baby Jesus' birthday.
Right.
So, how are you going to handle this in Green Bay?
What did he say?
Set it up.
Yeah.
Let's set up his birthday.
The fix is in.
Well, no. I mean, it's the eve of his birthday.
Right, that's right.
So
what's the setup, Jesus?
So Christmas Eve is the day you...
Oh, Joseph.
You set him up. You, you get everything in order for the birthday party. So I love this. It's a Catholic church.
Hold on, you have a visitor.
Hey, Dubs.
How's it going?
What's happening, dude? I thought we were going to do this tomorrow.
Oh, I just heard my name. I figured I'd walk by.
but you do want to make a bet about...
Well, he's here now.
You do want to make a bet.
Yeah, we'll make the bet.
Are you on a tattoo bet?
Sure.
Okay. How about on the forearm of the loser? Right here, like right between your elbow and your wrist.
Right.
Right here on your forearm. Mm-hmm. Score of the game. Green Bay, 27,000. Detroit, -87.
I'd be more comfortable with something I could cover up with a shirt if I have to get it.
Okay, well listen.
Could you wear a long sleeve shirt?
Because it's a tattoo shirt. You can, a tattoo.
How about a logo?
A tattoo bet.
He's done the score already. How about something?
How about a logo?
How about on my back, we put Packer backer?
Okay, what do you,
you just want more tattoo? What, another, like, length of your back? What about, but Don's saying he's going to tattoo also.
Yeah, I would put a tat up this time. Now, I'm not going to say I'll put on my back Lions backer.
What about a small logo of the winning team on the loser's back?
I would get a logo the same size as the Batman thing on my right shoulder. I'd say I'd go for the same one on my left shoulder. And, you know, Mike, that thing is, I can't take my shirt off now, but it's a large tattoo that I have.
Dubs, and you would get a Green Bay tattoo on your shoulder? Is that cool?
Yeah, that's fine.
All right, can your guy do it?
Yeah, my guy can do it.
All right, good. Please talk to Beth Ann about that. We'll do that on next Monday's show, then.
And there's a little...
Thank you, Dubs.
A little tension there. That's you never know on any given Sunday, so...
Not a chance. Not a chance. Not with my boys after the way they got just plastered. And, you know, that's the one thing about being a fan for a team. And I'm a fan, you know, good or bad. I got my Packers shirt on today.
Right.
Why is it, though, that people love calling when a team is losing? Yesterday, I got done with that thing at Marty Bass's TV show. Mm. I looked at my phone. There were 7 missed calls from 7 different people.
They were calling just because the Packers were getting killed? Now,
everybody from my brother in Wisconsin to the guy that lives up the street to me to my own son. Everybody just calling going, hey, Dad. Or that was a Barnes call in particular.
Right.
35-3. Looking great. They just took Favre out.
Now, and these aren't, most of these calls, your son, I would imagine, to commiserate because he's upset because he kind of likes the Packers, too.
No, he doesn't.
Oh, he doesn't.
No, he never doesn't.
Calling to bust your job.
And the thing is, I don't call these people when the Packers win and, like, do the la, la, you know,
right.
I'm a bad winner.
Right. Well, next to when the Red Sox won the World Series, I would get more regular season calls about a loss than I would a victory.
Okay, sure. Anyway.
That's because, you know why? People love to hate, though.
Here's the deal with Green Bay, and I love to hate, too, so I love them. St. Bernard Catholic Church in Green Bay, miles from Lambeau
Field. That's a dog of a church.
They have adjusted the Christmas Eve mass schedule for the Packers.
Excellent.
Now, the Packers are scheduled to play at 2 o'clock on Christmas Eve. What they have done is, and it's tradition for 35 years, they have 2 separate 4 p.m. masses on Christmas Eve day. They have eliminated those masses because that's during the game.
Right.
They will have a second big Packer backer Christmas Eve mass at 6 o'clock. Now, there is also a fallback. If the game goes to overtime, the mass will be moved to 7 o'clock. This is not a unanimous decision, says the pastor. Finally, somebody passed the buck to this guy. I guess they argue about it in the community.
Sure.
And the pastor said, that's it. We clap and cheer for the Packers till the game ends. Then we applaud the love of God that he made manifest in the birth of Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
If someone interprets this to mean that the Packers are more important than Jesus, then they're wrong.
Oh, wow. Well, you know, you can always tell a St. Bernard priest, instead of a white collar, they wear a small keg of brandy around their neck.
I got that mental picture, those dogs that always had.
Yeah, in the cartoons.
It always looked like a wooden
keg.
Like a barrel, a little baby barrel.
Like a barrel that you would jump over Niagara Falls
in. Exactly, right. And I think that's what was in it.
Right.
And that's why Rob wrote that.
Anyway, great in Green Bay. I love that.
Yeah.
I love the fact Packers are on it, too.
But, you know, you do have the devout Catholics there that are probably going, well, God's more important. And it's Christmas Eve, so that's huge.
It's Jesus' setup day.
Mm.
What's the name of the head coach? I can't
remember. Mike Sherman.
His church is not delaying the services, and he's Lutheran. So there's a lot of stuff going on up there. That's in Racine.
Anyway, I love that so much in Green Bay. Yeah, okay. Now, hold on. It is, like, the most holy day of the year. It's Christmas Eve. But Packers are playing a big game. Okay, I know it's been the first time in 35 years. Cancel the 4 o'clock services.
And it won't affect the midnight mass.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Thank God.
Thank God.
Thank God.
Unless the game really goes into overtime.
Well, if it's midnight, then you got a problem.
Then you're screwed. Okay.
You know, seriously, if I was in that area of Green Bay, too, I would urge people to go to the midnight service to watch people kind of wobble.
Mm-hmm. We got to break so we can get William Shatner on.
Oh, yes.
Let me give you a real fast feel-good, though.
Right.
And this is great. The only bad part of this is no one dies.
Okay.
Or good part. So there is a tanker a gasoline tanker. This is from Edwards, Colorado. It's got 8,000 gallons of gas and diesel fuel.
Mm-hmm.
It overturned and caught fire on an interstate. Mm. One of the tires from this truck jumped off the road and rolled approximately 450 yards.
Wow.
Rolled into the backyard of a subdivision, rolled through, again, one tire rolling on its own on fire,
mm-hmm.
rolled 450 yards down a hill through a guy's sliding glass doors.
Mm-hmm.
It then went into his family room, and the basement door was open, rolled down the basement steps, and set the guy's house on fire.
Wow. Wow. My God. Nobody died?
Nobody died. Nobody died.
Man, that's scary.
But what's great about it is that it's a tire. It's
a tire, a flaming tire.
It's just a tire. The guy's driving around.
But you can't put tires out easily either.
No, you can't. But what's great is you got to get the mental picture. This happens on some major highway.
Right.
The tire, just like the truck is on fire. One tire rolls away, down a hill, through a subdivision, through the guy's sliding glass doors, down the basement steps. The guy says, "Do you smell something burning?"
Oh, so the guy doesn't even notice that it's
down there? No, the house is on fire. And he says, "What the hell's going on?" He's so far away from the highway, wow. He can't even see that there's a truck on fire.
Oh, my. You know, why, for some reason, I'm thinking of the movie Red Dragon.
And there was another one this weekend, not as good, but another guy driving an oil tanker,
uh-huh.
I think in Colorado as well. The problem is, and I tell you, people, don't screw with the radio.
No.
If you're listening to our show, don't change the station.
You know about that.
Okay, so the guy is changing the station on the radio.
Fidgeting with his radio.
Uh-huh.
Ought to be illegal when you're driving a tanker. Yeah.
That's all it took for this guy to roll his gasoline tanker.
Unbelievable.
Shut down the highway for something like 8 or 9 hours.
Well, haven't you ever been on a highway and you've seen one of those fly by you? One of those tanker trucks?
Sure. Never.
Yeah, okay.
I'm the trucker's friend.
I've been on slick roads and seen those idiots go by.
Whatever it is.
With pure petrol in the back of their cars.
10-4, good buddies, that's Mike saying that, not Don.
They don't give a rat's butt.
Whatever it is you're enjoying right now.
Kill innocent people.
It got to you on a truck.
Yeah, and sometimes it doesn't get to you on a truck because the marble heads are sitting there driving 80 miles an hour.
Okay, wow. Again.
Hey, well,
Mike O'Mara saying that.
Breaker, one night, good buddy. Looks like we got us an extra slick road. Let's drive faster now.
That ain't me. But that's good.
Yeah.
That's good. I like that. So the tire goes into the guy, rolls into the guy's house.
It's amazing
that
he didn't notice it. What's that smell?
William Shatner.
Yay.
You know William Shatner, right?
I love William Shatner.
We have never had him on our show. Never. Even with all the Star Trek crap that he used to do.
Right? We should have had him on the show.
He's got some record out now. His album is called Has Been.
This is good!
I guess we'd pronounce it Has Been.
Now, does he do the spoken word stuff on his album?
Mike, we've got the album. We'll be reviewing it with William Shatner.
Oh, I love Shatner.
In just a moment. What else did they send along? Some dumb talking points.
No.
William Shatner's new album Has Been in stores now. An eclectic array of guest appearances, collaborators. Anyway, it's William Shatner, and it's a new
record. That album, though. Look at the album cover. He's covering his face.
That's great.
Or is he just, like, being pensive? Who knows? He's being Shatner.
And look at the back. The back is kind of a Rolling Stones thing, like from the album that had 19th Nervous Breakdown on his Mother's Little Helper.
Oh, yeah.
What was that album called, Robbie? Come on, real fast.
God, well, it was on Hot Rock.
Joe would know.
That's what I'm thinking of.
Joe?
Joe would know the Rolling Stones album. You just show him the back of that album cover, and Joe will know.
You got to hurry, because we're going to be late now for Shatner.
You said hurry and Joe in the same sentence.
Joe?
There he is.
Joe, what album does that remind you of? What Stones album?
Through the Dark Past, Through the Past Darkly, which was a best of.
Good job, Joe.
There he is. Thank you, Joe.
Thanks.
When'd you start putting that stuff in your hair?
I've always used this stuff.
Oh, really? I've not noticed it. What have you enjoyed for lunch today?
Today was leftover pizza and chili dogs.
Oh. Well, that's wonderful. You're supporting the tomato-based products.
Oh, hold on. What, Joe?
You know me and the tomatoes.
I know. They're rich with antioxidants.
Like this.
Yeah, the tomato is Joe's friend.
Joe,
just from me to you, man to man, next time use a Kleenex instead of your hair. I seen something about Mary.
He's gelling.
I get jokes.
Jelling.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show. His love of animals put him into a tank with a killer whale and gave him a close encounter with Coco, the mountain gorilla that learned sign language from her keepers.
A mountain gorilla is gigantic, and I got scared. So the only thing I could think of was to say to Coco, I love you, Coco. Because I knew that if I said I love you, then I'd start to feel I love you. It's a simple actor's trick. I love you, Coco. My advanced daughter. I love you, Coco. Coco, I love you. And I knew that my body was softening. I love you, Coco. And I got right in front of her. I said, Coco, and I looked into her deep brown eyes. I said, I love you, Coco. She put her hand out and grabbed me by the balls.
The Don and Mike Show.
Hello, friends. William Shatner here, lounging on the sun deck of a swanky hotel in sunny Miami.
How are you anyway? The Don and Mike Show.
How are you anyway? Well, we've been doing a radio show 20 years, and we've never had William Shatner on.
No, this is exciting.
I mean, he's been on, like, every frickin' frack, Johnny and Jeff and the Breakfast Flakes. And
right.
Finally, here he is.
We finally get him on the show.
Great William Shatner.
Yeah, finally on a good show.
Yeah, Bill, you're on the good one.
I was trying to find a good show. I couldn't find a good show. I spent my life trying to find a good show.
And I
end up with you guys, so I'm sure you're a good show.
God bless you.
If I may be so bold as to call you, Bill, may I?
Yeah.
Okay, William or Mr. Shatner. I mean,
what do you like? What do you like disc jockeys to call you?
What do I like?
Yeah. What do you like disc jockeys to call you?
Bill.
I think the interview.
William.
The interview will go much better if
it's friendly.
What?
It'll go much nicer if it's friendly.
No, no. I said it'll go much better if we know what to call you.
I know, but sir does have a distinctive ring to it.
Yes. Okay, all right. We can do sir easily.
We can do that, sir.
You, sir, are the finest man in show business.
There you see. Now, now it's going along the way it should.
You, sir, besides being great on all your shows, all of them, Star Trek, T.J. Hooker. All of them. You, sir, have managed to, and everybody tells you this, but let me tell you the same thing. You've managed to do what's so great, sir, is that you mock yourself, sir, but you do it in such a great way, sir, that it comes off as it makes you even cooler than you would have been if you weren't mocking yourself, sir.
And then, of course, the mystery is... Is he really mocking him?
Yeah. Yes, sir, that is the question.
That is the mystery.
Well,
that
if is you the can, question. I really do, and I'm sure you have been told, if you can take self-deprecation and turn it into an art form, you have, especially, I will say, people that have been on television and have become known for one particular character, a lot of actors seem to have trouble with that. A lot of actors we've had on the show. You
what
seem...
do they do? How do they react? You know, you say you're Rocky. Now, what's the reaction to that?
Sylvester Stallone. Well, no, we didn't have him. We had his mom. He said he doesn't like. He doesn't react to people when they say Rocky.
I use an example. The late Warner Klemperer had a great deal of difficulty being known as Colonel Klink.
What would his reaction be?
His reaction.
I don't want to talk about that.
No. You've got to give me guidelines.
What would you like? Guidelines for Warner Klemperer?
Yes.
He would want it.
He's dead, so you can say anything.
Yes. He would specifically want to talk about his classical music.
Hi, I am not Colonel Klink.
I would rather talk about the work that I'm doing with the National Symphony. I'm doing the National Symphony Orchestra. That's what I would like to discuss on your show. Please, if we could stop talking about Colonel Klink on Hogan's Heroes.
And he had one guy.
And then, because I don't know you, but I can hear the edge, you would go further and further and taunt him, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Well, it's not because we have an edge. It's because we're idiots and we just knew Hogan's Heroes. We don't go to the symphony as much as we should.
But the thing with you, sir, is not only...
Yes, Duke.
Not only do I like you from Star Trek, because it was cool, you know, when I was a kid.
I don't want to talk about Star Trek.
That's it. There you go. Problem. I also really like, before you play your record, I want to tell you, I thought you were great in that movie with Eddie Murphy and Robert De Niro, where you played the guy that you played yourself. You showed them how to, what was that? That's, oh God.
Bowfinger?
No, not Bowfinger. The one with Showtime.
Thank you.
Robert De Niro is an undercover cop, and they're going to film him to be on TV with Eddie Murphy. And Sir,
are you
on
telling me the plot?
I'm telling the people listening.
I read the script.
Sir on the telephone, he plays himself. Anyway, I thought it was great. Very funny.
How you doing, sir?
How are you?
Terrific.
How are you enjoying the interview?
Where are we?
How are you anyway?
Where are you guys?
We have a national regional show. We're based out of D.C.
I see. A national regional. That's an oxymoron.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
What does that mean, a national regional?
Means
I'll explain that to you.
You can find us in various pockets of the country.
We are nationally syndicated.
Deep pockets, I'm sure.
Deep pockets.
We are nationally syndicated, sir, but amazingly, we don't go to the major media markets. We're more...
You want them to find you.
Well, they found us, and they don't like us. We find that we play better in the heartland.
There you go.
You're right. In Podunk. That's cool.
You know, Podunk, yeah. Okay, you got it. Mm-hmm. Hey, now you know where we're at.
I'm on Ventura Boulevard in the San Fernando Valley.
Yeah. Are you having how are you doing out there today?
I'm standing there with a cup in my hand.
Mm-hmm.
I've gotten $2.50.
That's wonderful. You have done it again, and you're having a great run on that show, Boston Legal, and you're fantastic on that show. Are you enjoying yourself as much as it looks?
The most. Mm-hmm. It is hysterical. David Kelly is writing for it. Are you familiar with him?
Oh, yeah, the Paramus. Absolutely, yeah.
And he's a genius.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't use that I haven't used that term in a long time, except for two people I've worked with recently, which is David Kelly and Ben Folds.
Mm-hmm.
Ben Folds on your album, right.
Yeah. So David Kelly is this guy who writes like we walk.
Mm-hmm.
It flows effortlessly, or maybe it's not so effortless, but it seems that he once won an Emmy for the best dramatic show and the best comedy show in the same season, and he was writing all the scripts for all the shows.
Yeah, and on this show, Boston Public, you play, you know, the lawyer.
Yeah.
Call
me sir, but you got to get the name of the show correct. Boston Public.
I say Boston
is another
Legal.
Show.
Sorry, sir.
So
sorry, sir.
So that'll be two sirs.
Two sirs. Double the sir, sir.
Two sir with love.
Boston Legal on ABC at 10 o'clock.
Hold on, hey sir, you just screwed up the time.
No. 7 o'clock would be like the Western.
Okay. All right. But to that.
Except that it's delayed, so it's also at 10 o'clock. But I'm not going to tell you that.
Anyway, right. You're good on that show because you play again. Just a total, like every lawyer that we've ever known. Denny Crane is such
a total
a jerk.
I was wondering what words you can use.
Well, you can say A-H. I mean, we used to.
But besides your character on Boston Legal, if I can just ask you one more thing about it, it's not necessarily a jerk as much as you're losing it. You're starting to lose it a little bit. Isn't that right?
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, I love it. I love that.
Yeah.
Isn't the show Boston Market?
No, that's a chicken.
There you go. There's
the guys who turned chicken when they went to. Boston Legal.
Boston Legal.
But playing a guy who's losing it, but you don't want to lose it too much,
mm-hmm.
right.
And yet you want to keep the humor. So it's an interesting narrow path to tread.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're outstanding on Boston Celtic.
Well, I appreciate you saying that.
And your album now. If I could ask you something about your old music, when you did originally Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds back in the day. Was it like Batman? Because when I watched Batman, I was a kid. I loved it. I didn't realize that, like it was a joke on everybody that was watching, and you had to be smart enough to figure it out.
I don't think Adam West was doing a joke there. No,
no, I don't think so either. But
he's a guy with diamonds, and Mr. Tambourine Man showed the two songs that were most poked fun at.
Do you find that that radio shows use that tape from that?
Well, that's all I've heard. But if you were to play the whole album, or at least the whole cut from which that came. You at least get an idea of what I was doing. Whether I did it badly or not, I'm not equipped to tell. But the idea of the Transform Man was to relate literature with the literature of the day, which to me was the song. So I tied original music with some literate thing, like one of the speeches from Shakespeare or from Cyrano de Bergerac, and I think Cyrano de Bergerac, I think it was a speech. James, I will climb to no great heights, but I will climb alone. And it segues into Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, which the guy, or Mr. Tambourine Man, which the guy can't climb alone because he needs drugs, because it's a drug song.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So the idea was to act the drug song. Well, now, since the whole cut took 6 minutes and airplay was 3 minutes, everybody played the song.
Right.
So it would be natural to say, what in heaven's name is the fool doing?
And that seemed to be the common reaction to it.
Unless you had the intelligence and the perspicacity and the tenacity.
Right. Perspicacity? Hold on.
Yes.
25-cent word.
I've got it.
Write that one down, Buzz, and look it up for us.
What does that mean, sir?
It means you should have done that the people playing it didn't play the whole cut.
Right.
So that's where that lay. But the most fun was, after this album, Has-Been, came out, and Ben Folds came to Los Angeles, we did two concerts, and in the theater, and there were 1,000 people in each of the. It was a limited number of seats, and 1,000 people. There were lines. They were scalping the tickets, and we got these incredible notices. And at the end of the concert, as the encore, the lights went out, spotlight hit my clenched fist raised above my shoulder, and I put a finger in the air, and we sang Lucy in the Sky with it. To tumultuous applause.
Oh, that's
sure. Great.
How did you get hooked up with Ben Folds?
Well, he had heard, now here's the irony of the whole thing, he had heard The Transformed Man, and he had contacted me three years now, to do a number that he had written for me called White Oleander on his album, The Fear of Pop.
Right.
And it went off very well. It became a very popular song on his popular album. And then he came to town to perform, this was a couple of years ago, and asked me to do White Oleander on stage with him. At that exact moment, the Foos brothers, who had owned Rhino Records, who had poked the most fun at the Golden Throat Records that had poked the most fun at.
Right, those were all the CDs that had the compilations of all
exactly.
The celebrities singing. Right.
It's the perfect word that I was trying to remember for 2 weeks now.
gotcha, sir.
So they were in my office saying, we'd like you to do a record. I knew what they wanted me to do. They wanted to have more fun with me. But then Ben called at that exact moment. And I said to Ben, would you do this record with me? He said, yes. When finally we had a chance to talk, I said, what am I going to do? And he said, tell the truth. And I sat down and started writing some songs.
So the goal of this, obviously you said the your previous effort with Mr. Tambourine Man was a little bit misunderstood. What was your, what did you set out to do with this album?
Besides
tell the truth.
Well, really, you know, in everything, if you're a performer, is to entertain. And so I set out to entertain. But okay. I knew that people like yourself would be looking askance.
Well, let's play.
And I had to prepare for that moment when the truth and the sirs dropped away and the slovenly speech assumed.
Yeah, you know. You know very well. Before we play, I'd like to play a little of Common People. We don't play records on our show, but I'd like to play a little of this.
It's well into the cut because I start off slow and then Joe Jackson joins me.
Oh, really?
Wow. That's right, because you collaborate with a lot of fantastic
people. Joe Jackson, who had an original hit with this song 15 years ago, came to Nashville where we were recording and joined me. And he and Ben and this great group of musicians that Ben had put together came together and did this rather original version of Common People.
Okay. Wow. Right. Well, here. Oh, and also, I want to tell you. Did you know you're on the list of the 100 greatest Canadians of all time?
There are only 150 of us.
CBC has legendary Canadians.
Really?
Number one is
Mackenzie King.
No, Tommy Douglas.
It's not Alex Trebek.
Tommy Douglas was the pilot, wasn't he?
No, he was the father of Medicare. Then you have Alexander Graham Bell,
right.
Number 9, Wayne Gretzky, number 10, Neil Young, Mike Myers, 20, Celine Dion, 27, Gordon Lightfoot, 33.
I'm not happy about my placement.
No, I wouldn't be either.
Avril Lavigne, sir. Number 40, John Candy, 41. This is what's got to kill you. Pam Anderson is 51.
Not right.
William Shatner is number 56.
No, that's not right.
However, under 51.
However, you did beat out Bryan Adams and Joni Mitchell. So I think
maybe it wasn't like a popularity. Maybe it was just Here's the 100 you guys think.
It's the legendary, the most legendary Canadians of all time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, anyway, certainly much higher deserving.
Yes.
The number 56 is Sir on the telephone. And now to Sir with Love from the new album Has Been.
Here we go.
Is William Shatner, Common People. She's got an intro on
it. She came from Greece. She had a thirst for knowledge. She studied sculpture at St. Mark's.
Short intro.
That's where I caught her eye. She told me that her dad was loaded. I said, in that case, I'll have a rum and Coca-Cola. She said, fine. And in 30 seconds' time, she said, I want to live like common people. I want to do whatever common people do. I want to sleep with common people. I want to sleep with common people like you. Well, what else could I do? I said, I'll see what I can do.
Sir, this rocks a bit.
No, you got to let it go. Another.
Oh, I am. To
the supermarket.
I just had to tell you, this rocks. I mean, really.
Rocks,
not
being, man. Well, Joe comes on.
Not big position.
Not much. I said, pretend you've got no money. She just laughed.
I said, oh, you're so funny.
I said, yeah? Well, I can't see anyone else smiling in here.
I mean, he's well produced.
Yeah.
You want to live like common people? You want to see whatever common people see? You want to sleep with common people? You want to sleep with common people like me? But she didn't understand.
She just smiled and held my hand.
Hey, there you go.
Cool.
I love it. That's a good transition, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Cool. That kicks some ass.
And that's why I think Ben Folds is a genius, because each song is different, and in that same imaginative way, he put the song together. I mean, it's entirely him, and he's brilliant at it.
Well, those background tracks build, and that sounds like a hit record. Let's hear just a little of Has Been, the title track. Because this is good, too.
This is great.
It's got like a rawhide feel to it.
Right.
It's great.
Oh, this is good.
Let's go to the vocal here for a second with William Shatner.
You talking to me? You talking to me? You calling me? Aspen? What'd you say your name is?
Jack.
Never done Jack. Glad to meet you. Who's your friend?
Dick.
Don't say Dick. What do you know? And you, friend, what's your handle?
Don. Super Don.
Aspen.
Riding in their armchairs.
Hey, sir, you are crazy always.
Now,
I mean, you are great. I mean that as a compliment.
Now,
you are great.
The gist of Mr. Shatner, sir,
yeah.
The gist of Has Been is really, you obviously people have thrown that around at you over the years at various stages of your career. And what you're saying is, what have you done, pal? Isn't that the gist of it, really?
Well, that plus the fact that the word Has Been is a idiotic word in the English language. Doesn't mean you've done something and you haven't done something in a while, but you did something.
Yeah. At least you did something.
You did something, but of course everybody does something. I mean, whatever you do in life, you're going to take a walk. You've done something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, it's a. Now you're a has-been because you walked and you're not walking. Now you're eating.
Now, did Ben Folds come up with the concept of that rawhide style, or was that your idea?
That was Ben's.
That's right.
I wrote the lyrics
right.
On the way to Nashville, having read the has-been attached to my name.
That is fantastic,
sir. You are everything we had hoped you would be. I hope. And it did remind me of the song Ringo by Lauren Green.
Yes, Ringo.
You ever heard that?
No.
No, never mind.
But he's another Canadian. I bet he is enlisted.
Now, if I might be so bold to ask you, sir.
I think we can change this to Billy now.
Okay, Billy?
Billy.
Billy? Billy? What are you doing tonight? What's Billy Shatner doing tonight?
I'm going to tell you, man.
Okay. All right, dude.
All right, dude. Listen.
Yes.
Monday Night Football has always been like my rallying cry.
Yeah.
With people I know, I bring to my house. I've got an 11-foot screen.
There you go.
Show off.
Updated 11-foot screen.
Show
Monday
off.
Night Football. Food, beer, yelling and screaming.
Wow.
Haven't done it at all this year because I've been working on...
Oh, has been.
Well,
Boston Legal.
Boston
Legal.
So tonight is the first Monday Night Football I'm going to be able to party. I'm going to be able to throw.
Wow.
Outstanding. And that brings to, I'm so glad you said that. The last thing I'd like to ask you, please, sir, Billy William.
Yeah.
Do you know who Rich Eisen is?
No, but is he on the top 100?
Well, no, he's not.
No, I don't think he's Canadian.
He's the guy who used to work at ESPN, and he's on the NFL Network now.
Uh-huh.
And we have him on our show every week.
He used to be on ESPN, and he's a very funny guy, and he knows an awful lot about football. But
that's great. I watch ESPN. I did watch ESPN all the time.
And we used to give him a hard time occasionally. But what we do now, and it's a tradition we have on the show, is we have every luminary that comes on this show, and you, sir, Billy William, are a luminary.
Okay.
We have them record a little greeting.
He would just say,
I'm going to do it.
Hello, this is William Shatner. Rich Eisen is a jerk.
Yeah, or anything you want to add.
But I'm going to tell him, Rich Eisen, that you told me to say he was a jerk.
Yes, of course. You can say that we...
I believe
I'm going to do that right now.
All right, okay, here we go. Let's roll. William Shatner, go.
Hello, this is William Shatner. Rich Eisen is a jerk. Now, I didn't think of that. Everybody else has told me that. So I'm going along with the flow. He's a jerk.
Oh, beautiful. Oh, I think he's going to...
You, sir, are the greatest man in show business.
William Shatner, thank you, and good luck with your album. It's just been a pleasure to finally get you on the show.
Dude, really.
Thank you. We've got to do it again.
Please do.
Yeah. We would like to. No kidding, we'd like to. Thank you, T.J. Hooker, Captain Cook, Kirk, everything else. Thank you, Bill.
Bye-bye.
Bye, dude.
Bye. He's everything you expected to be.
Bye-bye.
I get the impression that guy likes being in his own skin.
You know what he says a lot?
What?
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
He's like trying to draw you out or whatever, but that's great.
Uh-huh.
And is everybody digging the theme to T.J. Hooker?
But what I had no
idea. Who knew this?
That has been... That's hysterical.
I know you can do it.
Oh, it's great.
Has been. It
sounds
Ringo.
Good. I think he was more in love with that other thing.
Funny.
Billy Shatner.
Has been.
You know, I think we're going to have to probably take that and put that in the replay.
I agree.
Because can't you imagine if we just happened to be talking and we were to be talking about somebody, anybody, and you say, oh, yeah, and incidentally, this morning on the Howard Stern show.
Oh.
I heard this on Howard's show this morning. Here's another one. Hold on a second. So, I'm with my wife last night, as I always am, my wife, Frida. We're watching TV and we see King of Queens with Leah Remedy.
Like that.
I got one.
Okay, hold on. Let me restart it for you, Mike.
Here you go.
I heard the other day that Opie and Anthony were doing a segment on their show, and I think they were interviewing Jay Moore.
We have a winner. No more calls.
Yeah. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Mike. Okay. Thank you, William Shatner.
That was great.
Now, we have money to give away for Christmas.
Wow.
Oh, boy.
Here's what I'm going to say Christmas, and if you're Jewish and you celebrate Hanukkah and you're a brother, you celebrate Kwanzaa, kiss my ass. I'm not going to do this holiday stuff. You celebrate whatever holiday you like, but Christmas cash sounds better than holiday cash.
Very good.
So, we've got a ton of money to give away because the deal here at Infinity is we have a promotional budget. If we don't use it up by the end of the year, it doesn't roll over to next year. We just lose the money.
Huh.
So,
but if you celebrate Hanukkah or Kwanzaa, you're eligible to win the money just like everybody else.
Oh, no, Mike. Only people who celebrate Christmas.
Okay.
Wrong!
We're going to play a game today to give away...
I try to help.
I know.
That's all I try to do.
Mike, I was just kidding.
I understand,
I think most people knew that.
Yeah, the first time you were, yes, absolutely. Yes, I understand.
Well, you think people thought I would be serious the second time?
Don, I'm just doing what I've been doing for 20 years.
Christians only.
Yeah.
But let me... You know what? I would really have to define that search
yes.
a little bit.
Yeah.
I couldn't be just as open as Christians because I hate a lot of them.
I understand. You hate everybody.
I do.
I understand.
I love to hate.
Do we need the chart?
No, not today. I don't think we need the chart today.
Because he has it ready.
I know he does. He's got it memorized, Buzz. Are you kidding? I have to write it down. $1,000.
Well, how are we giving it away? Jesus Christ.
Well, you got us. Well, Jesus Christ has something to do with it, Mike, because it's a Christmas cash thing.
Okay.
Happy birthday.
Here's the deal. $1,000. We love doing a game called Buzz Makes the Sexy Call for You.
Oh, do we?
Oh, hold on. Let me play Buzz in here. Hold on.
Good.
Yeah. What is it?
It's a hookah.
You know, Turkish water pipe. Looks like a seltzer bottle with a thyroid condition. Who would want a thing like that?
Michael Elston has Buzz birthday.
I thought we were going to play a song we recently got for Buzz.
Oh, no.
No, not yet, please.
You mean we're going to be playing a game now with our premier newsman and commentator, Buzz Burbank.
Oh, man.
That's just a joke.
Sure.
We're all making jokes today.
Sure we are.
Yes, we are.
Except when you have to stop the show to explain.
Sorry, I didn't want to stop the show.
You're uptight about that when I say,
Yes, of course.
I'm kidding, of course.
Of course.
Like the general manager of Channel 13.
I'm kidding, of course. That's me, the general manager of Channel 13.
That's a joke, too.
That's me.
Yeah, come on.
I know. I'm fine.
So am
what
I.
The hell are we doing? We're going to have Buzz make the call.
Yes, however, it's a different call.
Really?
It's not just a sexy call.
No?
It's a sexy holiday. They call.
Ah.
And
Merry Christmas!
Gay men only, please.
Oh, hello!
Yes!
Gay men. See, Mike, you missed the look on Buzz's face.
Really?
The look that said, yeah!
Did he grab his neck? It's the look you have just as you're about to go over the first hill on the roller coaster.
Listen, heteros, I promise all of this money will be available to you equally.
Absolutely.
This is right now. Homo time only. Gay men only.
Uh-huh.
If you're in a committed gay relationship.
That's correct.
And you would like Buzz to call your lover, your husband, your partner, whatever it is, with a gay-themed, love, sexy, holiday message.
Christian. Yeah, preferably.
Hey, see, there you go. Now you're catching on.
I just caught up to the show.
So, gay men only.
Right.
You call us. Buzz will then, we'll get the phone number.
Uh-huh.
Buzz calls your gay friend and leaves a, what, Mike?
I don't know, Don.
leaves a sexy gay message.
There you go again.
About the holiday.
Controversial. I don't know about that.
Wow.
And remember, this contest is GMO. Gay men only.
That's right. Don't worry. I'll legitimize it.
877-365-3636.
No problem.
With Buzz, we'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Listen, my friend. I am a supporter of the gay community. I wore a red ribbon to the Emmys. I have been to several Elton John concerts.
What does that mean?
Elton John is a gay.
The Don and Mike Show.
Got it? Man eater. Man eater.
Buddha Mouse loves the Don and Mike Show.
Yeah. Buddha Mouse does love Don and Mike.
Buddha Mouse.
DonandMikeWebsite.com. That's the only official website you'll find for the show with the daily recaps and the audio downloads and the pictures and the fantasy footballs and the affiliate list and the store. Yeah, thank you, Mike. And the store.
Yeah, the store.
And the store.
It's good stuff for the holidays, and if you order it today, you can get it for Christmas.
Christians only. Time for Buzz now.
As always.
Buzz.
Yes.
Oh, it's Man-Eater.
For two.
We have gay guys on the phone, Buzz.
Huh.
And we have $1,000 in Christmas cash.
Wow, super.
Nice. Now, rather than do like all the other dumb stations are doing, and no matter what city that we broadcast to that you're listening to us in, you got to know that there is a station doing the Christmas Wish.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
Where, you know, needy people write in with their stories about, you know, oh, this happened to me, blah, 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 blah. And generally, it's all really bad stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The disc jockeys, if they really wanted to help, what a radio station would do is say, let's find some really needy people,
right.
Let's give them money, and let's not make a big deal out of it.
Exactly.
We don't operate that way.
Mm-hmm.
I feel very badly for him. I'm sure Mike does. Everybody does. If you're in tough times this holiday season,
you're not going to get charity from us.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We're going to give away money, but we're going to give away money. I mean, I don't know. I can't imagine that we're going to do, like, how do you do an entertaining contest where you're saying, if you've got the worst down on your luck story,
exactly,
the worst Christmas, call us.
Other people do that.
So what you've got to do is come up with a new twist.
That's right.
Homos like Christmas.
Who doesn't?
Gays like Christmas. Homosexuals, lesbians.
Amen.
Buzz is very in tune with the gay community. And we have gay men from across America calling. Buzz, you laugh as if you're not in tune with the gay community.
Yeah, I get the newsletter. Buzz knows what's going on.
With your tight shirts and your designer jeans.
He's tapped into the life, as I like to call it. Oh, you know who I saw over the weekend?
Who?
A good friend, Cheryl.
Cheryl the Big Dyke?
Yes. I wanted to say hi to Cheryl.
What was she doing?
She came out to the parade. Came out to the parade.
Very nice.
So do we need any more example that gay people love Christmas?
No.
There she was. Gave her a big hug and a smooch.
That's nice.
It was good to see her.
How come you didn't inform me of that bit of fantastic news before the show?
Until you started doing all this talk. Well, I was shaken up by that letter, Don.
Sure. Oh,
and
right.
Before you started doing all this gay talk, I completely forgot Cheryl the Big Dyke.
Mm-hmm. Was she on a float?
No, she was not. I think she was in the crowd, Rob.
Wearing a harness?
She didn't have her harness on.
No. How did you recognize?
I had my kids with me.
Oh, understood.
Yeah. So I couldn't let her, you know. Normally, if the kids aren't with me, I say to everybody at the table, hey, Cheryl, show them your harness. Didn't get a chance, though, this time, unfortunately.
So Buzz, next year. Buzz, the deal is there are gay men on the phone. We have numbers of their partners, their wives, whatever, you know, they call their other, you know.
Partners, their significant others,
their wives.
No, they don't call them that.
Why does that make me laugh?
Because one has to be the husband, one has to be the wife.
Well, it depends on the day.
Even if you're gay.
Mm-hmm. The husband and wife.
So you will call the wife, partner.
I'll call the partner.
And you will give them a very sexy, keeping in mind that, you know, we don't do an R-rated show.
I understand.
A sensual holiday call.
On behalf of their significant other.
Mike, I ask your help here with your crap detector.
Sure.
We've all got our gaydar on, but we want to make sure that these
legitimate gay people only.
Real gay guys.
They're always fakers.
Let's start with Steve from Buffalo. Steve.
Hello.
Hello, Steve.
Hi, Steve. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Are you in the life?
Yes, I am.
Very good. Man, not thick enough.
You don't believe in Mike?
Nope, don't. Too whispery.
Okay.
Here's not flamboyant enough.
Sean. Hello, Sean.
Hi. Hello?
Hi, Sean. Sean, are you a man or a woman?
Man or a woman?
Yeah, I'm a man.
Sean, you're a man?
Yes.
And you're gay?
Yes.
How old are you, Sean?
29.
I don't know. He sounds to me like he might be one of those boys you see a Lifetime.
The Super Bowl is gay.
Like one of those boys you see a Lifetime movie about, you know, Not Without My Son,
right.
Starring Judith Light and whatever the kid is who was on Who's the Boss with her, you know, where the kid like gets the kid. What's his name?
Danny Pinatoro.
There seems to be a little tentative quality in these
he gets
early calls.
Into the gay lifestyle.
Are we moving on?
Yeah, let's try. Here's a real gay name, Brock.
Brock.
Hey.
Hello, Brock.
My boys. What's going on?
All right, Brock.
How are you, Brock?
Doing well. And yourselves?
Brock, we're doing great. You know us. We don't judge. We're just trying to make sure that you are who you are. You're a gay man?
Yes, sir.
How long have you pitched for that team?
Well, I got divorced from my ex-wife in 94, so from there on out, I suppose.
So you're like our friend Homo Joe, who had a straight life and then moved into a gay life.
Absolutely.
And have you known for a long time, even during the marriage, that you were gay?
Oh, yeah, my wife did, too.
Really?
Yes.
I guess it's but she didn't know before you got married, did she?
Well, yeah,
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. You know, here's the thing. He's got, like, that neck sound to his voice.
Yeah, like a little...
Really? I
didn't care for that one.
Necks can be gay too.
Yeah, I know they can, but Buzz, they're never public with it. That's always like the guy in American Beauty.
A song to sell.
Well, they have rodeos. What are you kidding me?
Hello, here is Paul from Florida.
I'm Paul.
Hey.
Hi, Paul.
Hi. Who's this? Don or Mike?
Okay, now you're laying this thing on real heavy here.
Well,
Paul.
The thing is though, we're the one. It's tough to make the call. Paul, are you in the life?
Yes, I am.
Mm-hmm. What's your partner's name?
Russ.
Ross or Russ?
Russ.
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 R-U-S-S.
Russ. And what is it that you like in particular about being gay so great? What's so great?
What's so great
about being gay?
Well, it's not really great.
Oh,
I mean, there's
great.
there's a lot of you know, people that are against you, but I've been pretty much accepted by friends and, you know, coworkers.
How about your family? Your family accept it?
Only on one side of the family do they know. My niece and nephew is.
What
on
is
the other side. On the other side of the family, nobody knows.
Sir, what is your, I said sir like you're William Shatner, what is your favorite Judy Garland song?
Over the Rainbow?
Bingo. He didn't have to hesitate. I think that's confirmation. Who is your favorite contemporary artist?
Now, he doesn't have to pick a gay person.
I really don't have any certain person that I like.
All right, how about give us your favorite, who's your favorite actor?
Seinfeld.
Jerry Seinfeld.
Jerry Seinfeld.
Yeah,
yep.
Jerry Seinfeld.
Hmm. Mm-hmm.
That is
do you like,
documented.
Do you like Will and Grace?
Yeah, I used to. It kind of got old, but it's pretty funny, but I don't watch it anymore.
What is your favorite Broadway musical? As we continue the stereotype.
Cats.
favorite Streisand song? You can't use the S word, my friend.
I stopped.
No, you didn't stop, but I got it anyway.
Okay, good. The one where she rode on the front of a tugboat singing that song.
That's
right?
Don't Rain on My Parade.
And finally, Mike, what does that say about you?
Hi there! I know that.
Okay,
from the tugboat.
Now, listen, all you closet homos, all you closet homos in the studio, don't answer this.
Okay.
Who is Peter Allen, and what is the song that he is best known for?
No clue.
You don't know who Peter Allen is?
No.
And you've never heard I Go to Rio?
How old, how old are you, sir?
50.
You're 50?
Mm. You don't know Peter Allen?
Really know Peter Allen?
No, I don't. I'm not really.
No, I'm sorry.
Disqualify him. Any fag hag would know Peter Allen.
Yeah. Boy from Oz. That was the musical about him on Broadway.
Yeah.
The boy from
Thanks,
Oz.
Rob.
Hello, Raj.
Theater Arts.
Yeah.
Raj.
Okay, tugboat.
Raj. Still looking for a gay
Rod.
Man.
That's the rest.
Oh, Rod.
Hey, yeah.
Hold on. His name is Rod.
Yeah.
Hi, Rod.
Hi.
No, I got the feeling he's fooling us.
Well,
too.
I don't know. We got to listen to him a little bit. Rod?
Yes.
What's your partner's name?
Michael.
You run out of questions.
We've been together for 14 years.
How do you weigh in on the David Guest issue?
Do you know who David Guest is?
Yeah, I've heard of him, but I'm not really sure. He's not a great guy.
I'm sorry.
No,
bye. It's hard to
the
find.
The Inquisition continues.
It's hard
real.
To find a good gay guy.
Up to that point.
Hello, Keith.
The Triple
yeah,
G.
Yeah,
the good gay guy. Hi, Keith.
Hi.
Keith.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, it's Keith.
Keith, what's your partner's name?
My partner's name is Chris. We've been together about 5.5 years now.
And what's your favorite drink?
Well, to be honest truth, I like beer, but sometimes I'm known to do martinis occasionally. I like the olive.
That's a legitimate answer.
I know you're looking for something grasshopper, but that's a good answer.
Yeah, the fact that he gave me that answer is terrific.
Can you tell us, please, first, have you announced to your family that you're gay?
Yes, sir, not entirely. I haven't been in and out of the lifestyle. I've been part of it the entire time.
Mm-hmm. Right.
100% bona fide.
And bona fide.
Honest answer, my father was slightly abusive growing up. My father, God rest his soul, but my father wasn't very accepting of it.
Yeah. Okay, all right.
I'm gonna sign off on this guy right now.
What's your favorite movie?
My Gaydar says he's gay.
He's okay.
What is my favorite movie?
Yes.
Well, it depends on what style of movie.
How about drama?
My favorite drama,
mm-hmm.
Kramer versus Kramer.
What is your favorite gay porno? Give us the title of your favorite gay porno.
If you can.
Are you serious? Rick Stallano's Anal Twist.
Okay. We've got a winner.
Don, I'm with you on that.
We've got a winner. Yeah, now, we're going to be calling your partner, Chris. What is it that you would like Buzz to say to him in reference to the holidays and the way that you feel about Chris, your love for Chris?
Just that the last, 5.5 years have been wonderful. He's so good to me. He's supportive. He's mm-hmm. there. We're really looking at a 5-year anniversary right now, but we were together about 5.5 years.
And what's interesting is we actually got together right between Christmas and New Year's there.
Oh. Buzz, I think you got more information than you need.
I sure do.
Yeah, okay. Hold on a second, Keith. We'll come right back to you.
And what's Keith's partner's name?
Chris. Keith and Chris. Okay, hold on there. And Robbie, if you call Chris right now. And Buzz, the good news here is that you don't have to do anything like, well, you know, this is not like one of our games where you've got to get him to answer an embarrassing question.
No, I'm just passing along a holiday greeting, in this case almost an anniversary greeting also.
But as you know, you do it in the style that you are so known for.
This is a variation on Buzz Makes the Sexy Call.
Absolutely.
You just spoke of yourself in third person.
Well, that was a title. I was stating the title of a feature.
I know, and I'm just kidding you, Buzz. And now I'm looking for...
I would have put that in quotes, but then that would have me making the annoying quote marks in the air.
You don't want to play the sexy saxophone?
Hey, guys.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Chris is out.
Out. Get it?
Ah!
Oh, that's a drag.
Hey, Keith. Sorry.
Yes.
Did you hear that on hold? Sorry.
You couldn't reach Chris.
Chris is out.
I was under the impression that you were just leaving a message.
We wanted to speak to him in person.
Oh, that's all right.
But Chris, hold on.
A different thing.
Hold on. Chris, you made it this far. I'll give you the first and sexiest all-female wrestling game. That's probably the wrong prize for you.
Yeah.
For Sony's PS2, Rumble Roses features the hottest wrestling action in the ring and the first ever mud wrestling mode. Rumble Roses, even when you lose, you win.
Wow.
Rated M for mature. Get it now on PS2.
Congratulations, Keith.
That's fantastic.
I'm sure you can re-gift it.
Yeah.
Hold on a second. Here's Mark. Hello, Mark.
Hey, Dynamite.
Hi there. Mark, let me see. Are you a gay man?
Yes, I am.
You are. Oh, hold on a second. There's somebody who was on first before you. John.
Hello?
John.
Hey, Dynamite.
Hi. How old are you, John?
I'm 25.
You're 25?
Yep.
Okay.
I've been a fan forever, and I even met Homo Joe, and I partied with him once after your Las Vegas-style show.
All right, okay. John, your wife's name is Owen?
That's right.
There you go, Robbie.
How long have you been with Owen, John?
3 years, in March.
And what is it that you would like, Buzz, and why is it that now I'm so believing? I was so non-trusting earlier. Now
I'm not. Now I got a little crap detector going out here.
Oh, do you? Because I believe this.
Yeah, I'm having a little deal with it here.
Well, go ahead. Ask. Do you have anything you can ask him?
Yeah, what's your favorite food?
Thai food, French food.
Mm-hmm. Thai food.
Well, I like Thai food.
Yeah,
that would be
gay,
one of
though.
That'd be one, hey!
That's really gay.
That'd be one of my first answers. I like Thai food.
French food, Thai food.
Most attractive male actor in the movies, in your opinion?
These days, I don't know. Colin Farrell's not bad.
Colin Farrell. All right, why not? Okay. That's good enough for me.
You passed the sniff test.
You like that.
Hold on, John.
What a great way of putting it, too.
What would you like Buzz to say to Owen?
Yes.
That he's very important to me. We've had our troubles, and, you know, if we won, I would surprise him with a trip. Because we've been talking about traveling, and we've never done anything,
Is Owen an older man?
No, he's my age.
Okay.
Very good.
Okay. This guy is so gay. Hold on, John.
You tell him about the trip. I'll take care of everything else.
So, Robbie, you told him he's on the air?
You got it in control there, Buzzy?
I think so.
Here is Owen. Now, Owen. Hello, Owen.
Hey there.
Owen, hi. Welcome to the Don and Mike Show. You should know that we have John on the other line. Stand by, please. Stand by, please, for a message from Radio's Buzz Burbank.
Already?
Hey, Owen.
Hey.
Buzz Burbank here.
How are you?
With a holiday message for you from your friend John.
Okay.
He says you've been together 3 years. There have been ups and downs, but you've been very important to his life.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants to bring you holiday greetings by saying he'd like to slide down your chimney, stuff your stocking, decorate your tree with big round ornaments. Have you been a good boy this year, Owen?
Pretty good.
Yeah. Well, John has a nice package for you.
That's brilliant.
And the biggest candy cane you ever saw.
Okay, all right.
Okay,
that's enough.
Now you're making all of us. Too good at that, Buzz.
Wow, Buzz.
Happy
holidays, Owen.
Now let's unite the happy couple. Here is
John.
John.
Yeah.
Oops.
Hey.
Oh, that's not what I was looking for. John.
Yep.
We have Owen on the phone
with us. Say hi to Owen, John.
Hey, Owen, how's it going?
Are you surprised by the call, Owen?
A little bit.
Well, the good news is, Owen, because you're a good sport, and we have Christmas cash to give away, that John has just won, for the two of you, $1,000 in Christmas cash.
Oh, my God.
Oh, they're happy.
Yeah. Owen,
is that John that's reacting like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, John, you heard we were giving away the money. Congratulations, John.
Oh, thank you, John. We love you guys, and I've been listening to you ever since I was a little kid, and this is the best thing in the world.
That's wonderful. What do you plan to do with the cash, John?
I'm planning on taking my baby on a vacation.
Where?
Where?
A cruise?
Where? I don't know. We could take a road trip to Canada for New Year's.
Oh, that's wonderful.
There you
go.
And would you just tell Owen that you love him, and then Owen, would you tell John you love him?
And then we can wrap this thing up with a nice bow for the holidays.
I love you, Owen.
I love you too, Dollface.
Dollface. That's nice.
Dollface. Mike, does that make your crap detector go off?
Yeah, it does.
No. That's from a movie.
What movie?
From a John Waters movie.
There you go.
What John Waters movie?
Desperate Living.
Any of them, okay. You know, really.
Right.
You know.
Winner!
Hey, if they're faking it, they're doing a good job.
Agreed. John, happy holidays to you, my friend.
Thank you, and to your family, too.
Oh, thank you. Let's not bring them into this. And Owen, best holiday wishes to you as well.
Thanks, right back at you.
Enjoy your $1,000.
Oh, thanks,
thank
guys.
You.
Okay, hold on.
We're going to put John hold
Owen,
now.
Goodbye, and John, hold on, please.
Thank you. Okay. You thank you, bye.
Congratulations.
Hold on, John. Buzz, if I might say this.
Yes, so that was, boy, that was more prepared than I've ever heard Buzz in my life.
You're a little too good at that, you know what I mean?
Come down the chimney now.
Well, it'll be a white Christmas for those boys.
Oh, God. Come on, Buzz, we're not doing that stuff anymore.
I have no idea. They're going to Canada. It'll be snowy up there. What are you talking about?
And the biggest candy cane you've ever seen.
Yeah. Who doesn't like them?
At least you said ornaments and not balls.
Yeah.
The one thing that was good there. And listen, we don't have like a 12 days of Christmas thing because we don't have $12,000 to give away.
Seven now.
We've got seven, and Batman tells me we may have a little less than that.
Okay. All right.
So join us tomorrow for another edition of the At Least 5 Days of Christmas.
Wonderful.
And we'll give away another $1,000.
That's exciting.
In a world where owning a radio was strictly forbidden,
Bareboten,
one man found a way to bring good news to his people.
Fag-hag.
He made it up.
Buzz.
Hey, here he is, your Studio 54 himself.
Buzz?
Yes.
What is your lead story? What's that guy on the Today Show, Rob? The guy that needs the kid? Is Cujo?
Oh, Stephen Kojo.
Well, what do they call him? They call him Kojo?
Kojo.
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 Hi, Kojo Burbank.
Hi, Donna. Hi, Mike.
Buzz?
Yes.
What is your lead story on the news and comments
today?
Oddly
enough, variations on a theme, perhaps. The cops have Michael Jackson's DNA. Is there evidence that matches it?
Ooh. Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Ooh. You're all worked up for that story now, aren't
sure.
you?
I suddenly feel like doing Merv.
Hi, Merv.
Hi. Ooh, Buzz Burbank, chimneys, Santa, Christmas ornaments.
Ooh. Stay tuned, everybody.
Stay tuned. For news and comments,
news and comments coming up
on the Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike Show. That was very...
Oh, that was very professional.
Yeah. It's the Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
The Don and Mike Show.
It's the favorite radio program of Charlie M. The Don and Mike Show.
Charlie M. Station break. How about in Norfolk, Virginia Beach, Hampton Roads? WBVA.
You made me drive down to Hampton Roads for Charlie M.
Charlie M. Reno. We love Reno on KBZZ. The Buzz, Burlington, Iowa. That became your affiliate station, KCPS in Burlington. Well, here, give them up for them.
Got me on the bus.
And Houston, KIKK. Dr. Buzz with news now. Buzz is brought. Oh, and for information on affiliates, go to dynamikewebsite.com. If you want to know where the show is on and what time it's on, we got the information there.
Right.
Buzz brought to us by Smoke Break. Smokers break the nasty habit without gaining weight.
This is good smoke.
Smoke Break, revolutionary tablet for smokers. Get it online at fine retailers. And now here's Buzz. Hi, Buzz.
Hi, Donna. Mike, with an update on a story from Friday. When sheriff's deputies returned to Michael Jackson's Neverland Ranch Friday, they were there to measure distances and lines of sight. When they arrived, Michael...
I know what you were thinking.
Yeah, you know, the, you know that you know. I know,
I know.
What I was thinking.
I used to talk about that all the time on the show.
Measuring distances makes me
laugh.
All right.
Remember...
Wow, look at that.
Here's all I have to say. For those of you remember the old show we used to do?
Yeah. I know, yes.
Remember?
Uh-huh.
I was in Detroit.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Ceiling.
I remember.
That's right.
Congratulations.
I know now what you're talking about.
Thanks.
Not so a do a chance lot of with me.
When?
No. Okay. I can't go any further with this.
No, not anymore, sadly. When the sheriff's deputies arrived at Neverland, Michael, on the advice of his lawyer, took his kids to Los Angeles.
Hey, that ain't stucco.
And this you should not do. You should not say he's an animal. He's a... should not say he's jacko.
Jacko.
I'm not a jacko.
Jacko.
I'm not a jacko.
Saturday, Jackson returned to the ranch alone and agreed to give a DNA sample.
Like dumping out a pixie sting.
A cotton swab was used to remove saliva from the lining of Michael's mouth, just like on CSI.
On CSI, that's right. Isn't that one of the best parts of CSI?
Yeah.
Where they got a bad guy or woman,
mm-hmm.
and they say, we're going to need a DNA sample. And the guy, invariably, mm-hmm. I think on CSI last week, the guy said, just give me a cup, I'll go in the other room. And they
like
love...
like a Dial soap dispenser.
They love coming over and go, all you got to do is open up.
Right.
Give us a little swabberoony.
They can do that, too.
Yes, they can. Now, hi, Michael. The question now, of course, is do prosecutors have some DNA evidence they're hoping to match to the sample they just took from Jackson?
Oh, I hope not.
Or is it a pretrial publicity stunt? Jackson's child molestation trial begins next month.
Like spilling honey.
A video that lampoons Michael Jackson is being criticized, meanwhile, by Stevie Wonder.
Like a soy sauce dispenser.
And here is what's nutty about this, Buzz.
It's rare for Stevie Wonder to speak out on anything, much less a video.
Okay, listen. Steve doesn't like the video,
uh-huh. right?
Here's the thing. Bulletin. Steve can't see the video.
He's blind.
Okay?
So you both say.
Uh-huh. Well, that's what we believed.
So you both say, this is from Michael Dossi.
Yeah, but Stevie Wonder says Eminem is a hypocrite for picking on Michael since M owes his success to black people. Wonder says he's really disappointed in Eminem.
Steve, how could you be disappointed in the video? You've not seen it, Steve.
Quote, for him to come out like that is bull.
Steve, are they still dressing you in shower curtains?
Wonder says he otherwise has much respect for Marshall Mathers music.
That made me giggle.
One time we had Stevie Wonder on our show.
I remember.
And I said to him, right to his face, he says, do you know that they have you dressed in a shower curtain today? He laughed.
He thought it was funny. He really did. I can't stop being Michael Jackson.
So funny. He's complaining about the video. Mm-hmm. He'd do it. You're blind.
You are the sunshine of my life.
A duet.
Don't call me Django.
Django.
The president of South Africa has set a great example. The other day, he donated blood. Ironically, his donation was intentionally discarded soon afterward, largely because the president of South Africa is a black man. That puts him in a high-risk group for the AIDS virus, and since he didn't fill out the required questionnaire, health officials say they had no choice but to destroy his donation.
Destroy it.
Quoting one health official, we had to decide whether to abort bleeding the president or to draw blood and then dispose of it. They decided to draw and then dispose of it.
And they call it bleeding, huh?
Yeah.
Bleeding.
But in South Africa, it'd be bleeding. Bleeding with that silly accent they have.
On Friday, health officials stopped the racial profiling of blood donors.
Please don't destroy my donation.
President Bush is...
I wonder what Ronnie feels about that.
I'm not sure.
We better stop it right now.
Absolutely.
We gotta stop that.
Be weird.
President, I'm Ronnie.
President Bush.
How did it do?
Stop it. I should have said it.
Yeah. Stop it.
Quiet you.
Well, President Bush is working on his promise to overhaul the federal tax system. And if you live in a state that went for Kerry in last month's election, get ready to pay. Conservatives are urging the Bush administration to stop letting you deduct from your federal taxes what you paid in state and local taxes. Now, that would hurt voters in every state, but...
Yeah, let it take us.
But since local taxes are higher in blue states like New York and California, the states that went for Kerry have the most to lose.
Texas, unbelievably significant. On one mind alone.
Californians reportedly already pay $58 billion a year more to Washington than they get back from Washington. The White House is reportedly just floating the idea for now.
Yeah. It's a floater.
Punitive. 1,000 airport security uniforms are missing. Homeland insecurity from the Great White North. Canada's Transportation Administrator is demanding to know how the uniforms got away, vanishing in batches at a time from airports throughout Canada. And over the past 9 months, 100 security badges have gone missing as well. Quoting a security expert, I suppose this had to come out sooner or later. The government's transportation chief says employee IDs are now being double-checked at every airport in Canada.
You know what you do? You change all the uniforms, and you do it right away.
All the badges.
Right. That makes common sense, and it would require money, and we won't do it. And what was the other thing? Buzz, I don't know if you have this on your news today. Mm-hmm. I think it was in France.
That's the next story, as a matter of fact,
okay.
If we're on the same page here.
Well, we got to be. Is this about their test to get stuff through security?
The French are having security problems.
I read about this.
In France as well. Let me tell everybody else.
All right.
In a training exercise in France, it went haywire. A package of real plastic explosive was set off on a round-the-world journey.
Sent off, Buzz.
At last report, French officials...
Not set off.
No, I know. I'm dealing with a lot here. At last report, French officials were still looking for it and issuing the statement, it is no more dangerous than a bar of chocolate. The 150 grams of explosive were placed in a bag on a conveyor belt to see if the sniffer dogs could find it.
I would like to say that is the proper detonation device that is not nothing more dangerous than a bar of chocolate.
Hello, bonsoir.
Bonsoir.
We seem to have a slight problem. All of the explosives are now gone.
I'd simply transfer the explosives to a man in a Canadian security uniform. It is fine. The poodles miss the explosives.
Now, somehow, during the exercise, a baggage handler managed to put the suitcase onto a cart that could have directed it to any one of 80 different jets.
80 different jets? I am very sorry. We have messed up, and I certainly hope you saw the Peter Sellers movie on HBO last night.
The French officials say the plastique is safe because it doesn't...
Plastique?
Because it doesn't have a detonator and cannot be set off by shock or fire.
Plastique, like my face. I am a mime. Look at me. The aeroplane smells of sea bomb. Thank you, Pepe Le Pew.
Charles de Gaulle.
That the newsman is so sexy.
And Jacques Chirac.
Yes, Jacques Chirac. We laugh at you Americans with your uptight rules for the adultery.
We do not know where all the explosives have gone.
We do not know. We are French. It is time to eat. We shall bon appétit.
We do not know where they are, but let me just say this to my wife.
Mm-hmm.
No need to shave your armpits today.
Oh, that would be... Hide the bombs in the baguette.
The U.S. military has been using what's called the stop-loss policy. That allows them to keep soldiers on assignment even when their enlisted period is over. During this latest war in Iraq, the military has been using that policy a lot.
Stay there for the duration.
Now, 8 soldiers from around the country have banded together to sue the army over that policy. They're home now. They say they're suing for the thousands of soldiers who were kept away from home after their time was up. As one overtime soldier explained it, he had held up his end of the contract. Now it's time for the government to hold up its end. Quoting another soldier, morale is on the floor.
Did everybody about Iraq, everybody I'm sure read that thing about Pat Tillman.
Right, Tillman, yes.
We knew that he was killed by friendly fire,
right.
But we didn't know how bad it was. And at one point, I guess during this exercise over in Afghanistan, when Pat Tillman was trying to indicate to the guys that were shooting at him,
hey.
He threw up a smoke grenade, to indicate he was on the same team.
Right.
The quote that I read in the Washington Post yesterday was, he was walking around screaming, I'm Pat freaking Tillman. Not as if to say,
yeah,
I'm an athlete, to say, I'm an American.
Right.
And I think that as I was watching the games yesterday, I feel oogie watching the commercials that the NFL has to honor Pat Tillman. Not because I don't think Pat Tillman should be honored, no matter how he died over there. The point is, he gave up a career in football to go do something he thought was more important. I'm all for that. What I'm not for is the fact that the NFL seems to find this as a rallying point,
yeah,
and they're using it to promote. I saw an ad from Jake Plummer, who I read was Pat Tillman's best friend.
Mm-hmm.
They went to college together. Pat Tillman's the guy that wanted to wear the sticker on his helmet all year. The NFL wouldn't let him. I'm cool with that
because mm-hmm.
they had a relationship. Mm-hmm. What I don't like is at the end of the commercial where you get the NFL logo coming up and you have the American flag coming up.
Right.
And you realize what they're doing is not honoring Pat Tillman. What the NFL is doing is saying, oh, this is a way for us to
promote the league, associate ourselves,
to get something out of the war, to turn this mm-hmm. guy, no matter how he died, mm-hmm. to turn him into a hero, but not a hero that we can honestly pay reverent tribute to. Somehow we can work this out to be a promotion for the NFL.
Yeah, right. Sick.
So they should just back off, and especially with this. This news came out on Sunday,
mm-hmm.
and the NFL was still running these bogus ads about Pat Tillman on Sunday afternoon.
Yeah. Elsewhere in Baghdad, 18 American soldiers who refused to go on what they believed was a suicide mission have been disciplined but not court-martialed. They are reservists who were ordered to go on an unquestionably dangerous transport convoy. They would have gotten no additional protection on a road that has dozens of bombings a week, and the vehicles were not in the best condition. The Army says the soldiers' performances were taken into account, sparing them the 2 years in jail they would have faced in a court-martial. When we come back...
It's going great over there.
The biggest Catholic payout ever on priest abuse.
Okay, sir, just line up over here and get your hands out, because you're going to get a big fat... And no, the priests weren't Irish.
And remember, no church during the Packers game.
That's right. Make sure the mass is held after overtime.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show.
They occasionally breathe the rarefied air of buzzdom. Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Hugging a tree. When you get near it, dragging the line.
Hugging a tree.
Dragging the line. James.
Making a living
the old hard way. Hi there, bud.
Hi, Donald. I saw my first stripper to this song.
He is ramped up today.
Man.
Always brings back memories. The Catholic Church has just paid out.
I think I bought that record when I was 13.
Uh-huh. What town? Wichita.
Rockville.
Yeah.
Oh, where I bought the record, not where he met the
war. Still on the stripper. Stripper,
okay.
Sure. The Catholic Church has just paid out its biggest settlement yet in a string of lawsuits accusing priests of sex abuse.
Now, I understand you might be a little confused, but if you line up over on, the left side.
Come on.
Oh, that's where you draw the line?
I like it when he finds your line.
That's my daughter.
Yeah. The Orange Diocese of Los Angeles agreed Friday.
Mike, you want to do it again?
Okay, Clancy. Line up over there. That's more like it. Thank you, Father Mordsky.
The Orange Diocese of Los Angeles agreed Friday to a $100 million payment to be divided among 87 plaintiffs and their families. That dwarfs the $85 million paid to 552 alleged victims in Boston last year.
What's up, guys?
I don't like dwarfs.
No word on how much the $100 million will come from insurance and how much of it will come from the diocese itself. And
yep.
The deal does not settle lawsuits of 500 other plaintiffs in Los Angeles and another 300 elsewhere in California.
But I only have one thing to say.
What's that, Father?
If it's an insurance company to be paying them, make sure it's Allstate. Because you're in good hands.
What's up, guys?
Thank you, Thomas Aloysius Gavin.
If you liked Ocean's 11, you'll enjoy this story. This is like something out of a movie. Three foreign gamblers arrive at the Ritz in London, a Hungarian woman and two men from Serbia. Using a laser scanner built into a cell phone, they calculate the speed of the ball during the first two spins and where it's most likely to land. Betting ends at the end of the third spin.
Betting to end! Wazai!
Using their high-tech cheating device, they won nearly $2.5 million.
Wow.
They were detained by police for a bit, but were ultimately released because
for
they're...
For a bit? Well, why were the police doing
for,
a bit?
I mean, for just a little while.
Oh, a short period of time. Not like a skit.
No. They were released because there is no law against what they had done. Today, casinos throughout London are beefing up security because the house always wins.
Well, this is a roulette thing that they did?
They calculated the speed on the first two spins through communications, radio communications, called what the third spin would be, you know, before the end of the third spin, called what it would land on, and obviously they were right enough time to win $2.5 million.
You mentioned Ocean's 12 because that's like a caper similar.
Right.
Here's what I wish they'd stop doing.
What?
I've seen enough ads for Ocean's 12 now.
Mm-hmm.
I already know the whole plot for the movie. I mean, do you really have to...
They wouldn't do that.
I mean, if you haven't seen it, too bad the ads, because you're going to see.
Right.
Here's the plot. They got the money. They waste the money. Andy Garcia finds Tess, and he says, I want my money back.
Mm-hmm.
She says, you already got it back from the insurance company.
Right.
He says, I want the money, $160 million, and I want 3 years' interest. Then Danny Ocean says, well, we are too hot to work in the United States. We've got to work over in Europe. So already, I mean, like 85% of the movie is gone. Because
Do you also find little Rat Pack stuff, all the shows that they're going on, a little forced, just a little too way... We're pals, we're crazy, we're kooky. I put the bumper sticker on his car, blah, 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 blah.
Especially with my gay guy, Clooney. I mean, I'm gay
him. Poor Clooney.
But I'm so tired of seeing him on these shows where he's saying, you know, hey, we all had such a good time. We would go to work every day and just laugh.
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe that's true. Maybe all
it's
these actors...
It's probably true, but I don't need to be hit over the head with it.
My point is, I like all of these actors. I'm going to go see this movie.
Of course.
For God's sakes, treat me with just a scotch of intelligence. Don't show me the whole freaking movie and trailers. And I'm not talking about in the theater. I'm talking about the ads you see on football
and a lot of movies.
Sitcoms. It's like... What's the point? I mean, I'll go anyway. You've got my money anyway. Right.
They know that. But,
Don't do me like that.
I don't know why they do that, give entire movies away in the promos, but they do it with a lot of movies.
Because I feel like I'm free-falling. Don't do me like that.
Right?
And you know the other thing about a movie like that?
What's that?
The waiting is the hardest part.
Always.
Yeah, but I know you won't change your mind because you won't back down.
I won't. I'm going to take my wife, too. Oh, here comes my girl.
Well done. In sports.
What? Buzz?
Yes.
You are jamming me. I'm getting very obscure, probably. Your wife's the only person who can keep up
on
these Tom Petty songs.
Tom Petty songs.
And you know about your wife?
Yes, what?
She's the All-American girl.
She is.
If you get into the Traveling Wilburys, we got trouble.
Damn the torpedoes, Mike. We got to move full speed ahead here.
That's right. In sports, while the Players Association meets in Phoenix to talk about...
Oh, and I don't remember the name of the but it's... Oh, but it's all right. It's all right.
Wilburys, While the players meet in Phoenix to talk about steroids, Colorado pitcher Denny Nagel is facing charges of picking up a hooker. Police say he paid a woman $40 for that special favor. They say he was pulled over for speeding and had bloodshot eyes and smelled like booze. They say his pants were undone. They say Nagel told them he was just being comfortable, but the hoe ratted him out. Joke's on her. Police seized the $40 as evidence.
That's a good deal.
And finally, I'm pleased to bring you this story in a world of ups and downs. In Hong Kong, subway service was delayed Saturday after a gang of 24 men stole the escalator. 24 men stole an entire escalator and the 6 steel pillars that supported it.
Wow. Yeah.
Taking crime to a new level. I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
We got to do it. That's enough retardation for today.
I'll be able to get that out of my chimney for a while.
See you tomorrow with a new episode. Everybody. Rod and Fez coming up next on JFK.
XYV and BZZ.
Our thanks to Billy Shatner and everybody else. We'll see you tomorrow with a new episode. Rod and Fez coming up next. DonandMikeWebsite.com, the official site of the show. Good day to you, sir.
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 And you.
Someone stole most honorable escalator.
Would you please go talk to my wife on the phone?
I shall.
She's calling for you.
Getting the end.
Till we meet again. This is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.